Good morning and welcome to this morning's meeting. I have apologies from David Torrance. And the first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item three in private. Are members agreed? Thank you, colleagues. Our second item today is two evidence sessions as part of our inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care. It's the first of our sessions on that inquiry. Before we start this morning, we had an informal session last night with service users and some third sector representatives who attended with some of our members to talk about their experience of alternative pathways. And I'd be very grateful if some of the members who attended might want to just give a quick summary of what they heard. Certainly in the session that I chaired, there was a lot of enthusiasm for green spaces type therapies, but a concern that the patients weren't being referred enough to them, and there wasn't an understanding of what was out there, both at the level of the referring GPs, and also there was a worry that there was quite a lot of really good projects out there but patients who could benefit them, or people that could benefit from them, particularly the most vulnerable of people that could benefit the most from them, weren't signposted or didn't have access to the information in order to access them. So lots of good things out there, but an issue with communication there. But we heard some good things from there. But we also heard that one particular person said that she had heard some attitude problems from medical professionals, particularly being quite dismissive of social prescribing as an option. So that was a little bit of a worry, and I don't know how widespread that is, but certainly that was one person's point of view. Emma, you were in another session.
Oh, thank you. Thanks, convener. Yeah, a bit of a mix. Some people had an absolutely excellent experience in accessing alternative pathways, and others were completely opposite. And a lot of the challenges were about communication, how signposting is delivered, and what pathways or what social prescribing is out there. All of the members did define what social prescribing meant, but some, it was very new to them. And so they were experienced barriers in when they called a receptionist, for example, when they called a GP practice, that the receptionist was the absolute barrier to any progress. So that was a couple of the issues. And one additional is that some other things came up about why can't we make online appointments? Why can't we just get text messaging to remind us when there's an appointment? And just joined up computer information data systems as well. So some of it is what we've heard previously in our other social prescribing session that we did in the last Parliament session. So it'll be interesting to hear everybody else's thoughts this morning.
Yeah, and echoing quite a lot of things that came through in our survey, which of course is available to the public as well. Sue, you were in a session last mm-hmm. night.
Yes, thanks. I suppose most of the people there didn't have anything particularly positive to say. I think, you know, they were all aware of the different healthcare professionals that are out there, but they weren't aware of pathways to perhaps access them. Everything was still coming in through that GP, was still that main and primary point of contact. In terms of signposting to the other healthcare professionals, it was very limited. Again, it was just quite disappointing to hear the reality of what so many people are facing on the ground, particularly there was in a number of different sectors. But that alternate pathways, the ones that the self-referral, again, there was no experience of that to anything that was taxpayer-funded services. Okay, there was, however, a couple of examples of where they'd found self-referral to alternative pathways provided by third sector organisations. Okay, so nothing that... And so there's clearly a lot of improvement to do. Again, in terms of social prescribing, I only had one panellist that mentioned the referral, again via the GP practice though, to the sort of active gym sessions in their local authority. And in terms of the using alternative sources, there's a lot of concerns around people's different skill levels and ability to try and navigate and find that. But online was a main tool. But again, there was a finding that phone line that would then open the door was helpful, but a lot of it was to third sector organisations or via the GP, which I think it just shows where the bottleneck is, and there's still quite a lot of work to do. And like Emma, I suppose I should also reiterate the level of frustration that many of the people feel about A, getting to see their GP and the receptionist at the door, yep, stopping going further.
OK, Stephanie?
Thanks, Convener. A lot of the things that other people have said there as well. Self-referral, waiting lists and being left in limbo was an issue. Feeling as if, you know, they hadn't heard anything for quite a long period of time. Not enough information and struggling to access the pathways as well was another issue too. And really highlighted especially people who were already vulnerable, so people who were elderly, perhaps in poverty, who didn't have confidence, who were suffering from depression, etc. Lack of knowledge in autism was another thing that came up. Some positives as well, though, on social prescribing, particularly it being really good for people who maybe don't have great connections in the local community and feel a bit isolated, and how that had made a massive difference to them. And pharmacies as well, getting some really good services through pharmacies too, able to access urgent medication that actually prevented an ambulance having to be sent to at very, very short notice. So a few positives as well.
Thank you, Stephanie. And Evelyn, you were there too.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I was in the same group as Stephanie, and I felt it was a really good session, quite a mixed bag in terms of responses. But I think what I took from it was that people were quite positive that there were alternative pathways, but the big issue was access and how we actually get the message across. In terms of how are we going to do that, how are we going to inform people that there are actually these alternative pathways available. So there was much discussion about how we could do that better.
Thank you very much, colleagues. So, and thank you to everyone who joined us last night. It was very informative. For our first panel today, we're going to focus on the patient's perspective of accessing primary care and navigating those alternative pathways. So leading very nicely on from the summaries that you've all given. And I welcome to the committee Val Costello, Patient Advisor for Citizens Advice Scotland, Patient Advice and Support Service, Margaret Mackay, the Chair of the Riverside Patient Participation Group, and Hannah Tweed, the Senior Policy Office of the Alliance. And the Alliance, of course, were very helpful in getting our people to our meeting last night as well, so thank you for that. I'm going to ask three of you to open it up to ask, what extent do you think that the public out there, and I suppose bodies like yourself, have been involved in the co-design of primary care services, particularly since the GP contract changed, and we do have these different strands of practitioner that are available to the public in GP practices, and of course everything else that we've been talking about this morning around the other alternative pathways that they might be able to be referred to. So can I maybe just go to Val Costello first of all?
Good morning. I work for the Patient Advice and Support Service and run by CAS in Lanarkshire. I think the main problem that we find is patients' self-health knowledge, their health literacy. If they don't know what's wrong with them, then they can't possibly self-refer themselves. So they are obviously going back to the GP. So that's a major issue for people who are not self-aware of what can be wrong with them, and people who have health literacy issues. Also, we also find that our main problem is the capacity of the alternative pathways. Do the alternative people, the physiotherapists, the nurse practitioners, all have the capacity to deal with these patients? We found in the patient advice service that the referral time for physio and for these other pathways can be really, really long. And if you're in pain, then they're going to go back to the GP. So that is a problem for our patients. We also find that there's not enough public awareness of the alternative pathways, and I think that really needs to be improved. We are having problems with it. I think people who access it and use it have good positive things to say about it, but it's getting to that point. Also, we have the digitally excluded general public who cannot access things online, who don't have access to mobile phones. That's also an issue for them. So that's probably the findings that we have from the Patient Advice Service.
Thank you very much, Val. And can I come to Margaret Mackay?
Yes, good morning. I'm Margaret Mackay. I chair the Patient Participation Group for the Riverside Practice in Musselburgh. So anything I say this morning really is based on the experience of one practice in one local authority area, which is East Lothian. You asked about the extent to which patients had been involved in sort of the co-production. I think I would sort of direct you back, I think, to the point at which the new GP contract came into force. Now, clearly, that was, that was a contract between the Scottish Government and representatives of GPs in Scotland. But the one group of people, I think, who were not actually, it's not so much that they weren't involved, because obviously a contractual thing, I appreciate, is between two parties. But it seems to me that what wasn't looked at there was, what was the impact of this going to be on the patients? And also, how were patients to actually understand the rationale for the changes that were taking place? So my view would be, based on our experience in Riverside, which is one of the largest practices in Scotland with 19,000 patients, is that in the main, the actual getting over to the public that general practice is changing, and why it's changing, and why it needs to change, and how, what's going to be put in place in order to ensure that healthcare needs are still fully taken account of, that I would say there's been actually an abysmal failure in that. But there really needed to be a communication plan that was at national, local, by local I mean either health board or local authority area, and then much more, even more at the practice level, there needed to be a coordinated, a story being told. General practice is changing. This is why. This is what we're going to do. This is the, you will be seeing different people, but you can have confidence in them. I mean, that messaging has taken place in some places, but it's been fragmented. It's not been coherent. It's certainly not been integrated, with the result that our experience is that most patients, until they actually come up against an alternative, really don't have any idea about why this is happening. Once they have the experience, I mean, for example, I put out a call to find out about people's experience of direct referral to physios, and the response back was very positive from patients. However, it's a certain group of patients who are more likely to find their way through the pathways that exist at the moment. In other words, the patients who are, might say, more able, have time to actually, navigate through this. So I think there's been a real, I'd like to think we should take a step back and say people need to understand, why is general practice changing? Because I don't think that's well understood at all. So therefore, you find still, sometimes it's pockets of resistance, sometimes it's just because people are not used to it, and questioning, well, why should I see an advanced nurse practitioner, even though she may or he may well be the best person to actually handle your particular circumstance. But there is a real need to ensure that services are not fragmented, that somebody somewhere is holding, the experience of that patient and the need of that patient's you might say their history as the patient themselves, but also the key member of the health team that they're linked into, and that of course up until now has been the general practice.
Thank you, Margaret. Very helpful. And can I come to?
I'd urge the committee really to take that step back and really get the fundamentals. Help people understand the fundamental. Why are GP practices changing?
Thank you. Can I come to Hannah Tweed?
Hi, thank you. I think this question of co-production is a really interesting opening one, because I think that actually at a very basic level, I'm not sure how much meaningful understanding of what co-production is we see across the board from people who access services. What I would say is that we do have examples where that's being done well. So I know that I have colleagues who work with a local information service in Scotland who did a fair amount of work to expand, to speak to people accessing that service about what they needed out of it for it to work. And that's a system, sorry, I should have provided a gloss there, which helps, it's a website that helps people sort of use by search by postcode or keyword what services are available in their area, often from the third sector, but not exclusively. But that's something that we know has been co-produced and co-designed with people in terms of what works. I also know that colleagues working within GP practices and deep end practices across Scotland have also been working on those lines about speaking about what forms of access work for people. But that's not everywhere. That there is real variable practice going on. And I think that also links into Margaret's point about there needs to be communication about why things are happening in order for those discussions to be meaningful. You know, if you don't have that basic, if that sort of comprehension of the why and what the alternative proposals are, it's much harder to have those discussions about design. But I do think we have examples where we have seen that and it works well and it's improving outcomes for people, which at the bottom line is what everyone I think is working towards. And give more detail on those, but I'm not sure how much you want at this stage.
Well, thank you. I mean, my colleagues will come in and probably ask for more details, and it's interesting because, you know, I'm nodding along, particularly when Margaret was speaking about actually how it's communicated. Because you see, we all see in our own areas where it's been communicated well and where it's been a reactive communication to a change, and it's quite problematic until people actually access the service. And if they get a good service, then they're completely fine about it. But that initial reaction to a change rather than a proactive information sharing about what's going on is an issue. I want to bring up, I mean, one of the things that came up last night and has come up in our survey is about the role of receptionists. And people have got, on the whole, are worried that a receptionist is a gatekeeper rather than a facilitator to access and healthcare in many cases. And I just want to go around you all quickly before I hand over to Sandesh Gohani for his questions. What you're hearing from the people that you speak to. So can I come back to Hannah?
Yep. I think that's certainly a perception that we hear. Whether or not that encompasses all experience, I think, is another question. So we've certainly spoken to a range of people for whom that was their perception and that was their experience. Others who had expected that to be the case and then were pleasantly surprised actually by, as you say, those good experiences. So a real mixed bag, if I can be that informal. I guess to me there's a real need for sort of something along the House of Care model to be really explicitly signposting and again back to that question of communication about the role of the receptionist as a facilitator, something that when it's done well really helps people in a streamlined process, but that also needs to be followed through by sort of meaningful support for those staff, because that knowledge doesn't come like that. You know, people need to be supported and able to be in order to be able to effectively signpost and link people into the communities. They need to have the resources to do that. And also there needs to be, going back to the waiting list comment, there needs to be sufficient timelines that people feel that they're not just being put off, that it may be the right place for them to be referred to. But if that means a 6 or 8 month wait, that's not an effective immediate intervention.
Thank you. And can I come back to Margaret?
Well, obviously, different receptionists will have a range of, you know, different skills and attitudes. And I suppose what is certainly needed is for there to be some clear, you might say, platform within any practice about how the receptionist operates. But I would like to actually take a step back from the individual receptionist, because our experience and in our practice, is that the issue is the receptionist, in a way, is almost forced to be the gatekeeper because it is really so difficult actually to get through to the practice. So, for example, if I give you an illustration, if you call our practice at when the line's open at 8 o'clock, in fact, if you call them almost any time, the first message you will get is that you're likely to have to wait half an hour in order to get through. Now, obviously, if that's the first message you get, that's already, you know, the patient's blood pressure, you might say, I don't mean in a medical sense, will start to rise. And so obviously when you do get through, the level of, you know, contact and communication with the receptionist is almost, it's almost predetermined because the patients have been hanging on to the phone for so long, and they're being told, you know, don't go off because you'll lose your place in the queue. So in a way, I think it's perhaps a bit unfair to actually, quotes, blame the receptionists, because certainly in our experience, they're forced into this gatekeeping role because actually it's impossible to get through to the practice, in most cases, in under half an hour. So sometimes, you know, we're sort of blaming, we're blaming the wrong person here. It's how, in fact, the access, the medical care in our practice is highly respected and highly commented on. The access into the practice, I think most patients would say, is devastatingly poor. And so unless one can tackle that issue, in a way, the receptionists are put in a, you know, a very, very difficult position because they're having to give this message, which I think is unfair on them, unfair on the patients, and it really needs, you know, what needs to be looked at, therefore, are the mechanisms for actually getting through the practice.
Exactly. It's about the system working for everyone. Thank you. And can I come back to Val Costello?
Yeah, I really agree with what Margaret has said, dear. I think receptionists seem to be in a no-win situation. When people call, they have to take basic information. This is seen by patients as triaging, and they want to know what kind of qualifications the receptionist got to triage their particular health condition. But there's also confusing procedures that they've got to cope with. Patients get text messages to say that their blood test results are now in, can they please make an appointment? And then they can't make an appointment. They wonder why the text message can't say you can have a telephone appointment on Thursday at 10 a.m. For example, it would just make things so much easier. Instead, patients have to, just as Margaret said, phone at 8 o'clock every morning to try and make an appointment. And these things are all building a level of distrust and dislike for the receptionists. And I think they are in a very difficult position.
Thank you very much. Sandesh, you've got questions.
Thank you, convener. And it's probably quite important that I say I'm a practicing working GP, and I was actually doing GP on Monday. So that's just yesterday. So, and it's very interesting to hear about receptionists. Without our receptionists, there would be zero access to us. And the abuse that our receptionists get is actually quite distressing to hear when they come and tell me about what some of the people have been saying to them. And I know it's out of frustration from patients, but there is a level which is unacceptable, and often it seems to cross the line. So I want to sort of go back to a point that Margaret made. In April 2018, the new GP contract came into effect, and amongst other things, the contract aimed to reflect the role of GPs and reduce the GP workload to allow GPs to concentrate on those things which only GPs could do, so be the expert medical generalist. Do you feel that this shift has been communicated to patients, and do you feel there is further things, and what are those further things that we can do to get that communication across to patients?
And do you want to direct it
to Margaret initially, please?
Margaret.
Yeah. Well, I think I hope I had made clear that I don't think has been satisfactorily communicated to patients. And I think also, the communication is the first step. The knowledge and understanding is the first step. But then the measures that you are then put in place in order for that objective, you know, to be achieved are also important. So, for example, if I can just illustrate it, I mean, if you there are alternative pathways in linked into our the practice that, you know, I'm here, well, I'm not representing the practice, I'm representing the patient's participation group. But if you ring in, whilst you're on hold, you're given the possibility of three different telephone numbers, all with different, you know, one's an 013 number, one's an 0162 number, one's an 0300 number. One would take you to, wouldn't take you to, it would tell you about the direct access to physio. Another would tell you about the CTAC issues, which are for wound care and advanced phlebotomy. And the third one would be for mental health. So you're getting these three different numbers on a message as you're holding on. And your objective at that point, of course, is to get through to the practice. You're also hearing about going to accidents and emergency. Don't do it unless it's urgent, unless it's essential. And you're also hearing about NHS 24. So clearly, what has not been done is to take that objective of freeing up the GPs to concentrate on those patients with complex needs or with multiple problems, and then to make sure that the alternatives that have been put in place are put in place in a coherent manner. So, for example, again, all of these different services, they have different opening times, they have different telephone access numbers. If you're a patient, you're trying to make sense of all of that is extremely difficult. Now, I realise I'm only speaking about one practice in one local authority area, but I think it's certainly not uncommon in that local authority area. So I do think if you're going to have these alternative pathways, there needs to be some coherence about them, some integration, and there needs to be, they need to have, at least mirrored opening times and access availability, and certainly that's not the case. And so from a patient's point of view, it's confusing, it's frustrating, and then it gets people angry, sadly.
And would any of our other panellists want to come in? I should have said at the very outset that on the platform that you're logged into, BlueJeans, if you do want to add to anything that's been said, you can put an R in the chat box ahead of it and I can come to you. Val?
Yeah, I think I would agree with everything Margaret has said there. But also, you have the situation if you're ill, if you're poorly, if you're in pain, you're getting all these messages over the telephone and you really just need to speak to someone. That's when the anger starts, and that's when the situation occurs where you have the receptionist and the patient having a standoff, and it's not good for anyone, I don't think. And I do feel that they are in a no-win situation, but they are definitely seen as gatekeepers rather than the gateway to help.
And Hannah?
Yeah, just to add, I would echo the comments that abuse to any staff or indeed any person is not acceptable. But I think one of the things some of our community links practitioners, so that's, I think we've got 59 links workers working across Glasgow and West Durham, Bartonshire, so not Scotland-wide, and these are the experiences to which I'm speaking. But where people have built up established contacts with people and trust with individuals who access and are supported by the links practitioners, that can sometimes be an alternative route. So if people are struggling to get through to other services or they're not sure where to turn, if they have a good relationship with a links practitioner, then that can be a route for them to, yes, be signposted via social prescribing to sort of community services and a range of others. But actually sometimes that sort of direction is actually back to the GP if it is auto specific. Medical professionals, and I think that can be useful for people, so that because they're speaking to someone they know, someone they trust, someone they've built relationship with over in some cases years. And I'm not saying that doesn't also happen with receptionist staff, because I think in some instances it does. But I think it's useful that you've got that alternative communication pathway sometimes for mitigating that potential frustration that can lead to the situations being described by colleagues here.
I want to move us on to talking about alternative health practitioners. Sue, you've got questions?
Yes, thank the panel for their comments this morning already. It's been really enlightening to have the evidence or the reasons and the justifications explained so concisely and made it quite obvious to us where some of the issues would be. And Margaret and Val specifically mentioned about the long waiting times for alternative health practitioners are also undermining the ability to alleviate the pressures on general practice, because everything is still funneled in through that. And we know that patients are more likely to default to going back to their GP again if they've got to wait too long. So what do you think needs to happen if we really are actually going to make meaningful improvements to the capacity for, on access and making them more available for these alternative health practitioners and their pathways?
Anyone you want to...
Val and then Margaret, and if Hannah can.
Val.
All of them.
Well, I think public awareness needs to be improved straight away. Public awareness of the alternative pathways. Everyone knows about the pharmacist, but they don't know about the other pathways that's available. The older demographic tend to self-care. The younger demographic can look up the computer, are computer literate, and that does work for them. I think if there's more awareness of the alternative pathways, that would help. But as I said previously, and as we've agreed, the capacity is an issue. You know, do they have capacity for all the possible alternatives to be used fully? And I don't know the answer to that, if they have the capacity or not. Is there ways to find out how long you would be waiting if you made a self-referral to physio today? Could you wait that length of time? What should you do in the meantime? These are all things that need to be looked at. How do they publicise this? How do they let the general public know what they can do in the meantime whilst they're waiting for their appointment? I think those are things that we need to work on.
Margaret?
Please, you know, is that part of an overall plan, which, as one of your previous committee members mentioned, you know, is about redefining or the role of general practitioner, then it needs to be very clear to people that that is in fact a service to which they have a right, given that they've got a particular need. Now, I mean, just to take one, I mean, I can only use, you know, examples that we're aware of. So I hope you'll appreciate that. Mm-hmm. I mean, at the moment, unlike perhaps what I've heard from one of the other members, a direct referral to the physio service in East Lothian would appear to be really quite straightforward, relatively short waiting time. Not an area of great complaint as yet. However, it's a relatively new service or a relatively new method. So obviously, the people who are accessing it in the early stages are what I would call the savvy patients.
Yeah.
Now, what will happen, you know, as the availability of that service becomes more widely known, more widespread, as it should be, because if that's what it's there for, as an alternative, it needs to be known to everybody. Then, of course, the pressure point in relation to waiting time, etc., I'm assuming, will grow. So I suppose one of the things that's needed desperately is to ensure that the knowledge of the available alternative service is actually known to all patients, not just the savvy patients. And I suppose as a patient participation group, that's one of our major concerns about what's happening at the moment, that the people who, you know, don't have access, you know, to the practice website or to the victim, you know, not able to navigate particularly well, either because they don't have access to the technology or they don't have the skills, or perhaps they don't even have the confidence to self-refer. So there needs to be a whole... Yeah, step back. How do we actually promote this service? How do we make sure it is available to all patients, not just to those patients who find their way to the top of the list, wherever they are?
Thank you. And did you want to hear from Hannah?
No, she's okay.
So you've got a follow-up question. I was going to Stephanie.
It was we've spoken about, but there's still 10% of people who won't accept an appointment with that alternative health practitioner, even if it was there, and they want that appointment with the GP. So why do you think that might be? And are there legitimate concerns regarding the availability of alternative health practitioners? I mean, we've spoken about communication being consistent, being national, etc., but we don't have consistent services, so we can't have a national message. So I think that's... So I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on that aspect of things. Margaret, perhaps, and...
Well, I agree that... When I'm talking about the message, it cannot just be one message. It has to be national, local or health board level and local practice level in a, you know, in a coherent, coordinated way. There's no point it just being one. There has to be a plan to communicate these changes that take account of all of those groups being on board and giving the same message out. The experience we're hearing from patients is that, you know, when they've had a direct experience of an alternative practitioner, and that's been a good experience, they're fine. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it's about people understanding, you know, what an advanced nurse practitioner is, for example. Also, I mean, using terms like a musculoskeletal specialist, I mean, that's a physio to me, certainly, and to most people that I know. So, you know, it's really about whenever there's any change, it's about looking at how will the patient understand this? Let's try and put this over from the patient's perspective rather than from the professional's perspective. I mean, it's a nonsense if a professional gets upset because they're referred to as a practitioner rather than an advanced practitioner. It's what the patient understands that matters and how they experience it.
Thank you, Margaret.
Thank you. Stephanie.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the panel for coming along today. I've got a question for Margaret as well. She's mentioned about, you know, we need the coordinated national and local messaging to the public, and I totally appreciate that that is the case there. What I'm wondering is, what difference would you say the patient participation group has actually made in her local area? How effective has it been? And what positives can we actually take out of that to improve the experiences of patients at a wider level? Thanks.
Margaret.
Okay. Our patient participation group was established in just at the end of 2018 when two practices combined. So there was it was seen that there was a need really to find a way of, I suppose it was a merger between two practices, and what were the implications of that for the patients? We carried out two surveys, one in at the end of 2018 and one at the end of 2019, where we interviewed 100 patients out of 600 attendees at the flu clinics. Now, 100 out of 600, I mean, it's a small number in terms of 19,000 patients, but it's quite a good response from a 600 attendees. And I mean, so this is pre-COVID-19, by the way, and I suppose that's another point I want to make, that many of these issues that we're talking about, they're, you know, obviously they've been exacerbated by the pandemic, but they were there, you know, before it. And so, I mean, the key messages that came out, we basically asked patients two questions: what's going well at the practice and what could be improved? And what I've been saying this morning really then remains the case, that it's the access. I mean, people were, once they actually got through and saw the relevant practitioner, whether that was the nurse or whether it was the GP, they were spoke highly of the service. It was the getting through, getting into the service was the key issue, and that remains the case. So to that extent, you might say, well, okay, so what difference has the patient participation group made? But all we can do is, you know, keep bringing to the practice, you know, this is the key issue for patients, and there are ways that, you know, that it could be, there are ways that could be improved, and we're happy to be a test bed for you whenever you, you know, if there's any change to be made, for example, to whether it be opening hours or whether it be the message that's on the telephone system or whatever. So I do think that patient participation groups, if they're well used, if they're used as a test bed for changes, they can be very useful and effective. If they're not used for test beds as a test bed for changes, then one would ask, well, you know, what role do they have?
Okay. Thank you, Stephanie. You've got a follow-up? Just checking with my colleague Paul O'Kane if you want to come in on this theme, or are we able to move on? No, we'll just move on. Maybe I can bring Paul back in later. Emma, you have some questions for our panel.
Yep. Thanks very much, convener. Good morning to the panel. So this inquiry is about alternative pathways to primary care. And in the last session, we did an inquiry about social prescribing for physical activity and sport. So not saying that everybody needs to take up cycling and running, but, you know, access to the outdoors, we know that that can be beneficial. We know that men's sheds can support people. We know that joining walking groups can be helpful as well. So I'm interested to hear from the panel about what the general attitude of patients, or what do you experience that patients' attitudes are towards social prescribing?
And if anyone you'd like to direct that to, first of all?
Maybe Val Costello, please.
Hi there. Yes, I think that's beneficial for a certain group, as Margaret would call them, the savvy group, the group who are aware that self-care works, the group that are aware that social activities can help and alleviate issues. But for the other groups, no, it doesn't seem to work for them. Again, down to lack of public awareness, and I know we've talked about it on a national level, but really in a local authority level, if people knew what was available to them, what they could join, what the process would be to join it, it might increase the uptake and therefore reduce the need for the GP, but they're not aware of them, and they will just always go back to the GP practice because they view the GP practice as a gateway to other alternative methods of getting better.
And can I bring in Hannah?
Thanks. I think that's an interesting link to the social prescribing and specifically exercise, in that I know when I was speaking to our team of community links practitioners before coming into this session and when writing up for use, we heard a lot of stories of people who live in the SIND areas of higher socioeconomic deprivation within Glasgow and Western Martinshire. So by and large, not necessarily I like the term of that Margaret and Val have been using around the savvy patients. Some are, but many who are actually, you know, more limited digital access. So not within that category necessarily, if we're categorising. But because they're working with links practitioners, they are still getting those referrals and seeing the benefits of it. So, you know, hearing from people who are seeking support for mental health problems, for example, referred to community groups around allotments, around outside mindfulness engagement, around different forms of community group and support. I think particularly during the pandemic, that the outsourced spaces were ones that people were more engaged with and continuing to access. And really seeing positive outcomes there, that people are reporting back that, you know, they're not wanting to access GP services as often, but that they are getting other people involved, they are seeing better outcomes for themselves, they're feeling better in themselves, all things that are, you know, what people want. And I think that particularly we've been seeing a real increase in people accessing, people seeking support from links practitioners. So, you know, we saw, I think between 2019 and 2020, we had sort of a 74% increase in referrals, which is huge. Even allowing for the fact that we had staff increase, that's still really quite substantial. And again, 60% rise in 2020 to 2021. So this is something that I think that's partially a consequence of the word of mouth effect, that within these areas, you're beginning to see people talking about this and going, actually, this worked for me. And you see that knock on effect. And that's not something that can happen like that. It's slow, but as it builds, you get momentum. And I think that links into some of the earlier comments around how things are communicated, that it does need to be embedded within the community, as well as having that national messaging. You need that sort of sustained engagement with specific areas. I think that's particularly true in population groups where you may see lower digital literacy, for example, or other factors that might make communication via email round robins more problematic. But yeah, we have, I say, surprisingly high reported increase in use of services and outcomes. Welcome, but a real shift there, I think, in how people are seeking support.
Emma.
We saw how the pandemic made people engage more in daily walk, access to the outdoors. Has there been a shift in knowledge about social prescribing because of the pandemic? Because we know that people were really isolated, so there was like telephone befriending services set up, and that would be seen as a social prescribing that isn't about sport, but it's about tackling isolation to support well-being as well. So has the pandemic led to an increase in knowledge about social prescribing?
And that's directed to Hannah.
Yes.
Sorry, I assumed it wasn't jumped in. Apologies if I stepped over someone. I think there's reasonable... I don't have concrete evidence for that, but I think there's reasonable indicative findings to show that. I think the fact that we found both our links practitioner referrals have been going up substantially, and I use that word specifically, but also that the number of people accessing ALICE, that's a local information service for Scotland, again, seeking those sort of befriending services, online, mental, you know, all sorts of different forms of community-based support have also gone up by, I think it's 34% during the pandemic, which I can get the specific stats, but I don't have them off the top of my head. But again, it's a noted increase. And I think that probably is linked in, certainly to the fact that people are and were more limited in how they could seek support. What I would say is, with our links practitioners in particular, I'm aware that they took a real effort to phone round, manually phone round the people they supported pre-pandemic to make sure that it wasn't just people who could email to be supported, that they were trying different forms of communication in addition to sort of generic letters going out. They were picking up the phone and they were making that effort. I think that's also got to be an important part of engaging people with those alternative forms of support and that sort of wider engagement with what it means to be healthy and be supported. I can see Val's.
Val wanted to come in.
Happened during the pandemic, although I think now people think that things have gone back to normal, if you like, and they tend to have fallen away a bit from that and are going back to their old and trusted method, which is to contact the GP practice. That will always be the way when there is a change. You know, people want to go back the way. That needs to be reinforced all the time, you know, the walking groups and things like this. The public knowledge has to be increased that it's still there, still available. There are other methods, and I think that is the main issue.
Emma?
Thanks. I'll go on to my final question about community link workers. There's when I last looked at the data, it's in March 2021, there was 218 link workers that had been registered or looked at on the Scottish Government's website, and it looks like we're on track to have about 323 by March this year as well. So community link workers are supposed to help direct people to what kind of alternative pathways, services, social prescribing is out there. So how can link workers, communication for what is available for people for alternative pathways and social prescribing? How can link workers help support that?
And we'll maybe go back to Hannah first of all. And I know that Margaret wants to come in on your last question, Emma. So I'll go to Hannah first of all, and then I'll come to Margaret to pick up on her points.
Yeah, I think that it's really welcome that we're seeing an increase in number of links workers. I've got a feeling, I'd be really interested to know whether we're on track for X number. Where's that from? Because I want to read it. My understanding had been we're well on the way, but I think it was sitting at the equivalent of 189.3 full-time links practitioners. So there's still room for that expansion to continue, I think. Also that I think where links practitioners are working within the area, that's a much easier sell, for want of a better phrase, because people have got the concept, they've got some word of mouth, they've seen some advertising. I think when it's brand new to an area, one of the things that's really important that we found is seeing that messaging go out in a range of different forms. And I mean that in easy read, accessible material, community languages, particularly in areas where you've got a great substantial, a large number of the population, English will be an additional language, really making that effort to engage with seldom heard from groups, make sure they're aware of how to access it, and again, using Margaret's phrase of the right to access services. And I think that's really key, and having that as part of a really deliberate part of the introduction of links workers within the practice. There's also a degree to which making sure the practice is fully aware of and that the local community organisations to which links workers may refer people have those established relationships and expectations. I think that work, that sort of initial legwork that links practitioners have to do around introducing themselves to people and organisations within the community, and so that they know what their capacity is. So again, you're not doing that thing of referring when people can't actually accept new members, etc., can be really part of that effective sort of common strategy, essentially. And I think there's also something to me about expanding the provision of CLPs as broadly as possible to really make this not an alternative route, but the norm, that this is the way that Scotland delivers a range of different care, that we can see people just expecting to seek support from a finance links, community links practitioner, or a community links practitioner as well as the GP or the nursing practitioner, that this just becomes the norm. And that's what I think we need to be working towards, that people have that level of information, that we've sort of broken that barrier that puts so much pressure on the GP system, and then all of the knock-on effects of that.
Thank you very much, Hannah. Can I come to Margaret?
Yes, I really put my R up in relation to the question before that most recent one about community link workers. It really was about the range of alternative pathways. I suppose one of the things that's, again, really important is, again, how consistent and how permanent are any of these alternatives in relation to the social prescribing that's being talked about? And I think that's one of the difficulties, that very often initiatives spring up either entirely volunteer-led, which is great if it can be sustained, or they're set up on a sort of short-term pilot basis. But actually, if you want to see a major change in something as profound as, you know, the health service that's provided, then it has to be sustained and it has to be underpinned. And I suppose one of the things this is not related to patient participation group because we've not discussed this, so I want to make that clear. But it does appear, it does seem to me that, you know, the role of public health has been so so important and so powerful in relation to the pandemic, that surely there might be a read over in how we can use the sort of public health service to actually demonstrate that, you know, all these youngsters who go to football clubs. I mean, in our area, there's football teams. I mean, they're full of young people. And if that message that this is also part of, you know, keeping you healthy, if that can be linked in with this sort of more strategic concern that the committee has, then that would seem to me to perhaps be something beneficial that could come out of what's happened to the pandemic, is that if public health could actually encompass, you know, referencing all of the other ways in which, you know, that we can keep ourselves healthy or grow healthy and strong. But that's just an observation. But I think also there is a very, I don't think we can get away from the fact that clearly the GP practices are under incredible strain. And therefore, if there are to be alternatives, like what they call CTAC centres, where now you have to go for wound care or for hospital blood tests, really these services have to be available, and they have to be available at pace and also in numbers that can actually draw the patients satisfactorily away from the GP practice. Otherwise it won't work. So there's really a resource issue there. You know, that all these other alternatives are being established, but they're being established without it being clear whether there's a right to them or whether it's just something that if the local health and care partnership chooses to support it and put the money in that way. And I think there needs to be a real drilling down about, you know, how these alternative pathways are actually being set up, managed, run, implemented, and what we're learning from them. I mean, it came as a great surprise to patients in our practice to discover that you didn't go to get any wounds dealt with at the GP practice anymore because, you know, it wasn't publicised. Well, that's something that's been pretty basic for generations. So you can't expect patients, you know, happily settle for that if they don't know about it in advance and don't understand why it's happening.
Thank you, Margaret. Hannah, I wanted to come back in briefly before I go to Gillian Mackay. Hannah.
Yeah, just a quick riff off the back of Margaret's comment about sustainability, which I completely agree with. It needs to be, it's pretty key, is that one ththing we have found is that because Lynx practitioner contracts are often relatively short term, we've seen a relatively high, we know of staff turnover as a direct result, not of dissatisfaction with the work or the support that people are providing in communities, but because they're on 1 year contracts and people need stability if they're to pay the bills. So I think there's also a question about how, if we are expanding Lynx practitioner and other alternative pathway routes, that is funded to make sure that this could be something that can really build on those connections that matter so much to the role. Thanks.
Thank you, Hannah. Gillian.
Thank you, and thanks to everybody for their thoughts this morning. Some respondents to the committee's survey expressed a pretty negative view of social prescribing. Some said that social prescribing was not the type of care they wanted or expected to be offered when seeking help from their GP. And one said they'd be insulted if they were directed to these services. Another said this represented an easy way out for the GP. The benefits of social prescribing are well documented. Does the panel think that negative attitudes towards social prescribing stem from a lack of awareness or a lack of explanation about the benefits? And does there need to be a greater culture shift with regards to what care people can expect from access from their GP? And could I go to Hannah first, seeing as she's nodding lots?
Hannah.
I mean, the short answer is yes. But to provide more detail on that, yeah, I think that's something we've definitely heard. We've both heard people who felt shortchanged, to be blunt, by being redirected to the Lynx practitioners. I would say in most cases, people did then begin to understand and were supported. I think the proportion of people who were referred and actually accessed services of those who sought help from Lynx workers in our area is fairly high. I don't have the stats off the top of my head, but you know, it's 11,000 and something of 11,000 and something. So it's but there is a culture change needed, and there is that real sustained communication needed to expand that, I think, particularly where the concept is new. And I do think there's a degree to which that's where support for reception staff is really important, so that they can help people begin that understanding of that this isn't people just being palmed off, that these are professionals who have really in-depth knowledge of local support networks, but also that they can see dual sources of support, that people can seek support from GPs or medical professionals about part of what they're seeking help for. But if, for example, they're seeking help for so the second highest rate of our community links practitioners support was for poverty related issues, basically, and support for filling out PIP assessments or social care or social security is much better to come from a links practitioner than a GP. So it's also about splitting where support is needed and communicating really clearly where that respective expertise lies. And it's not an easy job. There isn't a quick fix, but I do think it's a matter of really sustained and continued communication about value. And that needs to come from medical professionals as well as Lynx practitioners and other members of the community, that it's a sort of group effort to communicate the respective expertise.
If any other panellists want to come in, I'll just remind you, if you do, please use the chat box just to let me know and I'll make sure I come to you. Gillian.
Another concern I've heard raised by GPs about social prescribing is that it takes much less time to explain a prescription than it does to explain a method of social prescribing like a nature prescription. Do we feel that GPs' time is a barrier to patients understanding and engaging with social prescribing? And is the rationale behind and the benefits of it being properly explained to patients? And how can we better raise awareness if GPs have limited time to do so? And could I go to Val, please?
Val.
Yeah. So I think the main answer has got to be health literacy. If people don't know what's wrong with them, then they can't self-refer, they can't use these alternative methods. They must go through the GP practice, whether that's to see a GP, whether it's to see the nurse practitioner. If they don't know and they're not aware, that will be always their first port of call. I completely understand that when someone goes to the GP practice and the GP offers an alternative, that is not seen as what a patient would want, because they're looking for a tablet that's going to cure everything. And that's not always the case. And I think that does need a lot of education, a lot of knowledge, a lot of public awareness for alternative methods now. But again, it comes down to health literacy. What do the patients know? How savvy are they about their own health, and what could possibly be the method to alleviate their problems? We do have a lot of referrals in the CAB from Community Links workers regarding all the things that Hannah has said, because it's a well-known fact that if you're physically ill, then you're emotionally low, and all the other environmental things come into play too, your benefits, your employment, your housing situation. So that all comes through the CAB doors, and we are a quick fix, if you like. We're always here, but we're only doing a patch-up job, and then they're moving on to the next thing. It really does come down to health literacy, and it comes down to public knowledge and perception.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gillian. Thanks. Stephanie.
Thanks very much for bringing me back in, Convener. A question for Hannah, quite a quick one, I hope. I'm wondering about link workers and whether or not there's formal qualifications or training that needs to be undergone, or actually whether there's huge advantages in kind of drawing people from a range of different experiences and skills across the community, with connections across the community, and who are able to connect really well with patients themselves. Thanks.
Hannah.
I think that I know within our links practitioners, we've got people coming from backgrounds, and that's been really useful to inform their practice. I know that we have an internal sort of training and communication ongoing sort of support for individual system that, to the best of my knowledge, works well. I'm afraid I don't know I haven't actually asked my colleagues what their opinion is on formal qualification, and I'm leery of speaking on something about which I actually don't have information. Apologies for the bluntness. Although I think it's an interesting proposal, and one that I think that if was to be taken forward, would be really valuable to see a range of consultation on, about what that would entail, the pros and cons, and what the different elements of continued professional development would be as part of that. I would refer back to my comment though about keeping people in the role, and building on that expertise. I think that it's really important we don't end up in the same situation so many colleagues within social care end up in, where people move away from the profession and good support is lost, in part because of, you know, additional demands. So I'm happy to speak to my colleagues and come back to you on that one if that's useful. If you'd like direct input from people working in the role, please let me know if that would be of benefit.
Thank you, Hannah. And can we move on to questions from Evelyn Tweed?
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel, and thanks for your contributions so far. My questions are around digital services, and what I'm interested in is, do you feel that patients have and feel that they have direct control over their health using digital services? And how can we improve those services And I would maybe like to ask Val Costello and if anyone else wants to come in, that would be good. Thanks.
Thank you. Val.
I think those that are digitally included and know what they're doing can easily navigate through the digital services that are available. But as you'll know, that's not for everyone. And when it's not for everyone, it leaves a vulnerable group who don't know how to do this and are excluded from seeking the help that they need. That might be their point of turning to the GP practice, but it might also be their point of not really bothering about their health and trying to make do and trying to just cope with their condition rather than seeking out the help that they need. So there definitely is a huge gap there. I think digital services for younger demographic or those that are more tech savvy, that will work. But for those that are digitally excluded, there's going to be a gap and that needs to be filled.
And Margaret Mackay wants to come in.
Well, both in our written submission, I mean, this is one of the major concerns, I think, that as a patient participation group we have. I mean, just to give you an example, at present in our practice, the only way in which you can get a prescription or pre-prescription is either by doing it online or by going to the pharmacist. But there is no consistency in what each pharmacy offers in terms of accessing repeat prescriptions. Now, that's just one very sort of obvious example of a group of patients who are likely to be excluded from a very basic and quite simple service, the repeat prescription service. So, I mean, that's one of our biggest concerns, really, that, I mean, if you're able to look at the practice website and of all the various services that are listed there, even though it can be quite confusing because they all have different numbers and different opening times, but at least you can work your way through it. If you're not in a position to make that first step, then actually, you know, far from improving health equality, actually some of these changes are increasing health inequalities. And I know that may seem like a very strong statement to make, but that is something that we believe we can evidence. And I do think it's something I would ask the committee to consider really seriously, that if promoting health equality is a fundamental objective, both of whether it be GPs on the ground or Scottish Government ministers, then the digital divide really must be both taken account of and addressed in order to ensure that these changes that are coming in as a result of the changes in GP practices are not increasing health inequalities. And that's our fear.
Evelyn, would you like to come back in?
Yes, thanks, convener. Obviously, we've heard evidence that the public is accessing digital services a lot more, and they have been doing so during the pandemic. And there have been some comments this morning about a move away from that now, maybe trying to go back to GPs more, etc. How are we going to get the message out that, you know, about alternative pathways, doing things slightly differently, digital services? And I think Val had touched on this, and I wondered if she had any more thoughts.
Thank you. We had a very good TV campaign for walking and for getting out and getting some fresh air. That's definitely dropped off the radar now. We've got a radio campaign going just now. When I say we, I don't mean me. We've got a radio campaign going just now for GP practices and for the reception staff. And I think that's a very positive message to give out. But I think all of the services that we offer have to be fitted to the local authority as well as national. I think the local authority in each practice, as you will all know, runs completely different from another practice. So some practices it's phone at 8 o'clock in the morning, some other practices it's not that. Some practices it's phone between 1 and 3 for blood test results. Again, all this information can be found on the website. but some people can't use the website. So how do we promote that? It has to be in local press, it has to be in local radio, it has to be just out there so people can see. It has to be in posters on the walls in the GP practices, and that might be a better use of the message that people get when they phone the GP practice. Here are a list of our services, rather than call this number, call that number, do this, do that. I think that we need to really improve public knowledge of alternatives and how they can find out about their services, because they've changed and we have not changed our message to let them know that they've changed.
Thank you. If I may, I'd like to ask from the perspective of mental health support, and particularly some of the online mental health support that young people have been accessing during the pandemic and have benefited from, and learning from the success of that and continuing that. Have any of you got any experience of where the online services have been something that have worked for particular demographics of people, and how we can as take that learning from the pandemic and incorporate that into a more long-term strategy for those who want it. I'm not saying it's right for everyone. Anyone would like to come in, just please raise your hand and I'll come to you. Val.
Advice and support service, we do help people to keep their progress going. So if they've been referred to going online to Breathing Space or some of these other ones that the GP has prescribed, they quite often will phone the patient advice service and say, oh, I don't think it's working, or what will I do when I come to the end of it? So our role is to keep everyone engaged so that they know what they're doing next. And we would do that by contacting the GP practice, sometimes on their behalf, or encouraging them to contact their CPN or the mental health team to discuss what they do next. But yes, there are some successes, but again, I think it comes down to the people who can access those types of services. And as Margaret has said, there's a huge gap for those that can't. And the gap widens. The more that we put our services online and the more that the health services are online, then it kind of isolates the people who cannot access those services, yeah. Which is a real shame, because we have had anecdotal evidence of them working.
Mm-hmm. But they're not right for everyone. Can I come to Hannah Tweed on that?
Yeah, I think there's an interesting challenge here in that I'm really curious how intersectional the analysis of the results of online mental health support services, where they work and where they don't work, and how that information and data is being collected, reflected upon, and used to inform policy. Because, and this is anecdotal, I'm not claiming otherwise, but we've certainly heard from some people for whom it's been really welcome. It's been a much more flexible method of accessing services. Particularly for folk for whom going out and about to an appointment is much harder, either for reasons of personal mobility or because of care responsibilities. But we've also heard from individuals who've been directed to them, essentially just because directed to online services, not because they're most fit for purpose, but because waiting lists are shorter, under the understanding that sort of specific anecdote of someone who was directed towards an online mental health support services went for that because it was a shorter waiting list, and then was informed that if it didn't work, after a couple of sessions, it's no problem, you can go back on the waiting list for in-person. It's no, that's a route. But in practice, that didn't happen, and they just got discharged and went back to the back of the queue. And it's really hard to challenge those sort of systems. So I think there's something about transparency and consistency and making sure that there are options to raise it when people have problems, particularly when we're talking about mental health support, when even just going out and seeking that takes a degree of emotional and cognitive energy that people often have in a very limited stages at that point in their lives, because of a whole compound list of reasons. And I think it's really important to drill down to the demographics of where things don't work and why, and use that to be countering and developing, and to make sure this is digital choice. And I think this also riffs off one of Margaret's comments about the digital can be great, but it shouldn't be digital first. It needs to be digital choice, that people can have that range of access and points of access, and we really need to be cautious about both losing good practice that has been developed during the pandemic. You know, we need to keep that and build on it, but also make sure that everybody is being heard from. And I'm also thinking some of the real practice specifics. So, for example, we've heard of mental health support services that offered online support, but only if you could have a quiet room where no one could overhear, which if you have childcare responsibilities, that ain't happening, if I may be so blunt. So, yeah, I think it's also about looking down to that sort of real level of detail about what it means and how other things can be accommodated to make sure that this suits as many people as possible and where that needs to shift.
Thank you. Emma, you wanted to come in.
Yep, thanks, Convener. It's just a quick question. Hannah mentioned Alice earlier, and Alice is something that's the local information system for Scotland that is funded by the Scottish Government and it's delivered by the Health and Social Care Alliance. So I'd be interested to know what's your perceptions of how it is working, because it is a digital and online service to direct people to what social prescribing or is out there. So it'd be interesting to hear what the panel's thoughts are about Alice.
But initially you want to start to with
Hannah. Yep.
I mean, I'm obviously going to be speaking from a position of an organisation that is part of ALICE, so I'll just own that bias. I think for part of the population, it's a really excellent resource. Although I offer that with the codicil that it should not and cannot operate in isolation. It must be part of a wider package. But for those for whom online access suits, I think it's really good because it's community-based, because organisations offering support services can update their own records and their information practices. They can have different forms of communication, so they often detail phone numbers as well as websites. We know that we've got GPs as well as community links practitioners who use ALICE as a resource for seeing what's available. So it's not always just about individuals having to access website themselves. It can be a more flexible approach if the digital access is difficult. Excuse me. But yeah, we have seen a 34% increase across 2020-2021, which indicates increased use, if nothing else. But also interestingly, we've seen nearly four times the rates of referrals to ALICE from NHS Inform. So I think there's a lot more people coming via that route and seeking support, which to me is welcome, because the more routes people have to information that will help them, the better. I see no harm in that, as long as there are also alternative routes for those for whom digital does not suit.
Thank you. And now to a final line of questioning, and we have touched on it throughout this session, but health inequalities. Gillian.
Sorry. Thanks, Convener. I'm concerned about, and we've touched on this earlier, I'm concerned about the inverse care law. And as services are placed under increasing strain and may become more difficult to access due to growing waiting lists and practitioners having to see more people with more complex issues, and the system becomes more complicated to navigate with people expected to self-refer to different services, is there a risk that the inverse care law will become more entrenched, and those with lower levels of health literacy will become less likely to engage with health services, and how can we mitigate this risk? And could I go to Hannah first, please?
Thank you. Hannah?
Yes, it's a risk. And it's one that I think we have to be very aware of when planning and communicating. And I think that's where, I think everyone is going to say Val, but I think everyone has commented on this. I think this is where really targeted and deliberate communication is important, to make sure that the areas where you're aware that fewer people are able to access information is you know, really developed very consciously. But also that requires really quite detailed data analysis. So what data is being collected about who accesses different services directly versus via GP referral, and how is that being broken up by intersection in terms of intersectional, insofar as people are happy to share that information, and you know, people should have access to information held about them, etc., GDPR compliant. But I think that's a really important bit of work that probably puts an onus of responsibility on Public Health Scotland or other colleagues within the sector who may not thank me for that. But if you don't have that intersectional analysis, you're going to miss gap, you're going to miss things. And that's where you do end up with a very real and serious risk of entrenching existing health inequalities that we know exist, that we know have been exacerbated by the pandemic, and that bluntly, if they're not responded to, it's going to get worse. And that would be inexcusable given current awareness of the situation. I know that it's something that the GP at the Deep End report was reflecting upon, and about the real need to see the balance between specialist and generalist services reset as part of that sort of access point. And I think drawing on the expertise of people working within GP Deep End practice is a really important part of that as well, because those are the areas with greatest health inequalities that are most likely to be affected. So that would also be part of my suggested sort of where the expertise lies, and the people accessing those services should be part of that process. Plus data.
Nice.
Thank you. And I'm not seeing any other panellists wants to come in, but Gillian, have you got any other follow-up questions?
Thank you.
At all? I'll just double-check that our other panellists don't want to come in off the back of what Gillian asked there. Margaret? And then Val.
Well, I hope it's maybe been clear throughout this discussion that certainly from the one local patient participation group, this is probably our most serious concern. So my answer to your colleague's question is definitely yes, that is a risk. And I could just give you a very short illustration of it. I mean, I'd refer to how the satisfaction level being high in relation to direct referral to physio. I'll just give you an example, which I did put in my written submission. So a patient self-refers, there's not an availability at the local health centre for physio, but they're offered an appointment the next day in North Berwick, which is a 32-mile round trip. So this patient has access to transport. If they didn't have the transport, they would have enough money, if necessary, to take a taxi or resources to get them there. But, you know, if you're in a position where you are on a basic level of income, or if you've got caring responsibilities, or if you've got young children at home, how on earth would you make that 32-mile round trip for one of the alternative pathways that's being promoted? But I just leave that with you as an example, and would just really emphasise that I see this as the major risk of the fragmentation of primary care services. Now, it's not an argument against all other specialists being involved in the care of patients, but it's about how do we ensure that there's a real clear coordination, clear understanding of the role, and also that the services are not fragmented.
Thank you, Margaret. And can I come to Val?
Really, I just wanted to reiterate everything that everyone has said, but basically I think communication is key. Targeted communication is key. Things are beginning to open up now, and I think we need to look at making sure all third sector people know, all third sector organisations know of the alternative pathways, and they're able to cascade this down to their users. Also, carer groups, parent groups, every kind of group. It needs to be a targeted communication, and also by a local authority as well as a nationwide communication process. Really, that's all I wanted to say.
Thank you. And can I come to final questions from Paul O'Kane?
Thank you very much, convener. I think in terms of the evidence, the written evidence, multiple witnesses had commented that alternative pathways had potential to increase. And I think we've kind of heard quite a bit of that paper through any of the answers. But really, I think I just wanted to get a sense of what are the mitigations we can put in place? I mean, I think we've heard some of that this morning, particularly in terms of digital, although I'm still not quite clear in how we ensure that people have the capacity that they would need in order to access digital. That's obviously a bigger question, I think, beyond just health. But I don't know if there's any reflections on some of the immediate mitigations that might be able to be put in place. And I don't know if we want to maybe start with Val.
Thanks. I think I'm not really sure is the answer. We do offer services in the CAB. We do offer services from the patient advice. So if they can't use digital services, we will do that for them and with them. But I think there is a wider issue and it has to be addressed as a national event so that people can access the services that they need. And I think that right now we have a situation where there is an excluded group, and that's unfortunate. But more than that, it's very tragic because they may need services and they're not able to access them, and that's just not right. And we have to try and make sure that moving forward, it's an all-encompassing process.
And can I come to Margaret Mackay?
I think I won't say more about the sort of digital gap. But in terms of alternative pathways, I mean, when the alternative routes are being planned, what's absolutely clear to our patient group is that if services are being removed from where patients normally would expect them to be, i.e. the GP practice, then they need to be available within the same sort of, you might say, walking distance or transport distance that patients would have been used to with their GP practice. You know, so for example, if you're taking the wound care service, if that's being removed from the GP practice and it's going to be located in what's called a CTAC centre, it's no good in an area the size of East Lothian having two CTAC centres, one in Haddington and one in Musselburgh. You know, you need to actually have those alternative provisions within the same striking distance that a patient could have expected with a GP practice. Otherwise, you're building in an inequality. You're building in inequality because people need to have access to transport, or if they've got, as I've said, caring responsibilities or young children that make it difficult for them to be away from home for a long period, then in fact, you're actually, in planning that service, you're building in the inequality if you don't ensure that you look at it from where is the patient sitting, where is the patient living, and if I have to go to an alternative place rather than my local practice for these services which are now being transferred into an alternative route, then they need to be at least as readily available, and better still, even more so.
Thank you. Paul, do you want to follow up on any of that?
I think just briefly, I mean, I think that was very helpful in terms of Margaret's observation, because I think public transport is a key part of this in terms of reducing isolation. But I suppose I'm just interested if anyone has a reflection on just on the digital element, I think. So as we see challenges, I think, around things like library services and places where people would normally perhaps access IT if they don't have regular access to that. Now, that obviously has been compounded by the pandemic, but we also know there are challenges in terms of these services being available when they're run by local authorities. Do we need to see more, McMillan, for example, offer a cancer service through many libraries, which I think is very helpful and very welcome, but do we need to see perhaps more engagement between sort of library services, maybe more funding for them from the health stream in order to support them as a hub, I suppose?
I'll come to Val.
The Scottish Government already have a contract with the CAS for the Patient Advice and Support Service, and that's what we are, Patient Advice and Support Service. So should any patients need access to digital services, they can access that via their Patient Advice and Support Service. There is one in every local authority. So the Patient Advice and Support Service, usually there's more than one worker, sometimes two, in each local authority. They can help patients to do this. We are busy. There's no doubt about it. We're very busy, but it's not something that we can't help with. We can help, and we do help. We're not capturing everyone that we need to help, but our service is there. It's already up and running. We have local knowledge. We have national knowledge. We have extensive knowledge of the NHS and how it works. We have extensive knowledge of each of our local GP practices. We're here. We're available for use. So please promote the patient advice and support service, because that is what we do. That's what we're here to do.
Thank you. And we are about to run out of time, but I'm going to come to Hannah Tweed very quickly for a final comment before we break.
What Val said, plus the codicil I would add to any proposals around libraries, all in favour of libraries and community provision, is that recent closures have tended to be centred in areas of higher deprivation, with more going back to those conversations about health inequalities. If you're going that route, I would strongly recommend targeting specific interventions and focusing in the areas where there is most likely to be need and most likely to be digital exclusion, rather than to ensure you're countering that disparity.
Thank you. Good point to end on. Thank you to the three of you for your very helpful evidence this morning. And you've raised some points which I'm sure we'll be following up in subsequent panels. We're going to take a break and we'll be back at 10:40 with our next panel.
Welcome back. Our second panel today is also contributing to our inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care, and we'll focus on the perspective of doctors and nurses in GP practices. And I want to welcome to our committee joining us online. We've got Wendy Panton, the Senior Nurse of NHS Lanarkshire, Scottish GP Professional Nurse Lead Group. We've got Dr. Chris Williams, Joint Chair of the Royal College of General Practitioners in Scotland. And we've got Dr. Anurag Yadav, the General Practitioner from the British Association of Physicians of Indian Origin. Welcome to you all. I'm going to hand over to my colleague Sandesh Gohani to open questions.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for joining us today on the panel. There's a declaration of interest. I'm a practicing GP for anyone who's watching, didn't watch the first session. So my question on our first theme is around the new GP contract that came in 2018, and the idea of this new contract was to widen services and to allow people to get more without necessarily seeing their GP, and the GP was very much supposed to be the expert general practitioner. But what we found with the contract is there seems to be huge variability across the country. So my question is, has the contract, and especially I think to Dr. Yadav, as I know he's from a more rural community, has the contract impeded your ability to work and access for patients?
Thanks very much, Dr. Rohani, for giving me the opportunity to talk at this important forum. As you rightly said, I'm from one of the rural community GP practice. I'm a full-time GP in a Tibet medical practice in Hoek. I'm also in the clinical teaching role in University of Edinburgh, and I already seen a clinical lecturer there. So the Scottish general practice has gone through quite a lot of change, mostly positive indeed. I would start from when the COF was initially abolished. That was a big change. And then the GP contract from 2018 had a very good vision to improve the general practice in Scotland. So it is, you know, the vision of putting more funding into primary care, more collaborative working in the multidisciplinary team. So this has the all positive things which we would want the general practice in Scotland to move forward. But there's challenges that, which I think has been kind of the biggest one, is the delay in the contract, how it has been marred by delays in terms of the targets. So initial target from 2018 was to accomplish many things by 2021, but understand that there have been kind of things beyond everybody's control, like COVID pandemic came in, and now the target is up to 2023. Understand that there's a bit of lack of planning and there's lack of staffing, which has been a kind of a big hurdle. Even though we have got these services which are very good, they are very promising, but the lack of staffing is a big issue with them, and that is keeping things progressing further. Another important thing which I'd like to point at this point is communication to the primary care and communication to the general public has not been much. In terms of patient expectation, has not been taken care of when these changes are being made. So we will definitely want some kind of more patient education, more awareness to them, to see what changes are coming in primary care, like there are changes in signposting, social prescribing. So these are very important things which can only be possible if public is on board in these things. And this will these are very good and very important areas which will help to reduce the workload in general practice and help us see more core group of patients, you know, where we need the medical attention more, that will help us more in making our workload more manageable. COVID-19 pandemic has kind of put into forefront some of the inequalities in healthcare, the GP contract has been trying to deal, but those things have got still a long way from where we can deal with them. So there are inequalities in the attainment and different problems in ethnic minorities. There's kind of, not only that, you can see the geographic differentiation in terms of how their achievement in different things in primary care, in terms of attainment for different areas. Like, you can see the chronic diseases are more in kind of more deprived area, which is not a new thing, but it's more exposed to people who have got like economic issues in terms of poverty, low income, homelessness. They have been more exposed. People with disability, chronic conditions, they are again, the disparity is more exposed. Again, similar thing for social and cultural issues, which I would say is again coming into the forefront, which I think we need more to do. So overall, that we are moving forward from 2018 contract, but I would probably want some more input to tackle these issues from the point of view of mainly the staffing crisis, which I think is very paramount. The social and cultural issues is again, which is very important. And Mr. Convener, I just want to highlight to you about the things BAPIO is doing in terms of how BAPIO stands for British Association of Physicians of Indian Origin, and we have got a vision. We have got special expertise in terms of how people are managed in terms of language and cultural barriers, and the experience we have got. We would want to partner with Scottish Government to make this more workable for all the population, especially for the ethnic minority working in Scotland. There's another very important thing which I talked about, staffing. BAPIO has got this vision of how to manage the practice load in primary care. They have got this option. In fact, this is already in work in progress in England, where BAPIO has arranged for the primary care. It's kind of a wheel and spoke model where we're talking about a ambulatory care type of project in primary care, where the GPs can refer to a urgent care facility, where there'll be doctors looking after these patients in terms of getting all the investigation done as a kind of one-stop shop. And this will reduce the kind of workload going to the hospital, reduce the workload to the primary care. In terms of workforce shortage, we have thought about maybe getting doctors from India on, and getting doctors from abroad who will be trained by BAPIO for 2 years in India, and then they'll come here and get trained. Do part of their training for 2 years where they will work for 1 year in hospital, 1 year in these primary care settings. So this will help to run these primary care, ambulatory care unit type of projects. With this, I will like to conclude my case here. Thank you.
Thank you. And we'll go to Dr. Chris Williams and then to Wendy Panton. Dr. Williams.
Hi, good morning. Chris Williams. My clinical work is as a GP in Granton-on-Spey. I'm here today as the Joint Chair of the Royal College of General Practitioners Scotland. RCGP is the professional membership body for GPs in the UK. We support GPs at all stages of their career, from medical students considering general practice through training, through qualified years and into retirement. The college has devolved councils in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland, and we have approximately 5,000 members here in Scotland. And we're also proud to have patient representatives who feed in to help sense check what we're thinking, what we're learning. So we weren't involved in negotiating the contract that came in, but we're obviously heavily interested in seeing these changes improve what is available for our patients. We're obviously interested in conditions where working in general practice is sustainable. I was struck by a comment this morning by Margaret Mackay round about how were patients to understand. So it's essentially picking up that there are lots of changes going on at the moment through the contract. In general practice, things are constantly changing anyway. We're constantly adapting to the world outside us, the world around us, and the health and social care challenges that are there. But through the contract, we saw some specific changes. and was just alluded to there, attempts to make workload manageable. From the survey responses, from the evidence given already today, there are lots of people who try to access general practice for a very wide range of things. And we want to see access met. We want to see people be able to have an easy, straightforward route in. And again, from the comments earlier this morning, I think Val Costello was very right to pick up on the health literacy aspect, that our starting point is that we have lots of people out there across Scotland who don't know what's wrong with them, who have fears, who have concerns, and that they want to, you know, an answer in a time that's going to allow them to be able to get on with all the other things that are going on in their life as well. So part of what I would also pick up on in the college's role in the new contract is trying to understand the refocused purpose of the expert medical generalist. And some of what was said earlier today cuts to the heart of that, that there are some things that are complex, there are some issues that are difficult for people to raise and or who think that others won't be able to understand them except for a GP, and that might be a GP that they know and trust, but that might be that they see a GP as bringing a set of skills and an ability to understand difficult problems that aren't clear. And I guess it goes it gets down to GPs being able to navigate all sorts of territory, not needing a flow chart to do so, to be able to sort of understand the complexity and carry risk. But the very real root of some of the issues that we're discussing today is we do not have a large enough GP workforce. We have known for some years, say that we don't have a large enough full-time equivalent workforce. And that some of the measures are built in to try and support things. And mixed in this inquiry, I think there's also elements where we're picking up on new ways of working. And that we're also trying to understand a bit about how the third sector organisations and assistants can bring in, again, new ways of doing things, new ways for people to understand their health, to do things that are that are not medicalised. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I come to Wendy Panton?
Hey there. Thank you very much for this opportunity. As I said, my name's Wendy Panton, and I work for NHS Lanarkshire, but today I am representing the Scottish General Practice Professional Leads Group. There are leads from the majority of the territorial, 18 territorial and non-territorial boards, and we, as I say, we represent all of nurses working within general practice, whether they are GPNs, general practice nurses or advanced nurse practitioners. I am not working at present as a GPN. I work as a senior nurse, as I said, but I have almost 20 years experience of being a practice nurse. So I think that the original question was what impact the GP contract has had, is that correct? So I think it's quite a difficult question to answer, bearing in mind what has happened within the last 2 years with the pandemic and how much of an impact that the contract has had. Obviously, I can only speak from a nursing perspective, and the GP contract was a contract between the government and obviously GP general practitioners who do employ practice nurses and ANPs working in general practice. As a group, we feel that the idea of a general practitioner, the doctor being the first point of call, is quite an outdated approach, and it's not really a reflection on current practice within general practice. GPNs and AMPs are highly trained, highly skilled individuals, and are often majority of the time, the first point of contact for long-term conditions, which, as you know, is a huge part of general practice. We also felt that perhaps that the general public do not have the knowledge, they haven't been informed about the skill set that these nurses have, and perhaps that is something that should be better reflected. Often when some patients are given an appointment by an advanced nurse practitioner, for example, the comments that anecdotal comments that I've heard from AMPs as, well, I didn't know that I'd be seen just by a nurse. So it's kind of making the public aware of that, you know, what the skill set is, how these nurses have been trained, and the vast experience and expert knowledge that they have. We also thought that perhaps the term alternative doesn't really demonstrate that professional role of nurses working within general practice, and that where in fact that nurses working in general practice are essential and not the alternative. Alternative perhaps could have connotations that it is a lesser experience of care that you're going to get, where in fact it's not, it's the complete opposite, where it's certainly going to be at the, you know, at a level working within the scope of practice. Perhaps to allow clarification, they could state that what the nurse is, or another different in general public, as a nurse, where in fact, you know, we have got different specialities: general practice nurse, ENP, advanced nurse practitioner, district nurse, etc. So just again to reiterate things that had been said previously, kind of lack of knowledge and communication of what's happened, and you know, that's perhaps that's no fault of anybody's really. You know, the last 2 years and still ongoing has been unprecedented, and the these changes in terms of what the GP contractor did has done in terms of like CTAC, immunisation, urgent care, etc. These things were always going to go ahead, but because of the pandemic, it would perhaps appear to the general public that it's because of the pandemic when in fact that the plan was in place prior to that. But if they didn't know this, then people can't be expected to have that knowledge. So exciting times ahead, lots of great opportunities for nursing within general practice. So thank you.
Thank you. Sandesh.
Thank you. And just on your point there, Wendy, I have to say my practice nurses are better than me when it comes to chronic disease management. So they are very skilled members of staff. Dr. Williams and Dr. Yad have both spoke about sort of a staffing crisis within GP, with approximately 800 new GPs coming online by 2027. But the worry is they'll all be wiped out when it comes to retirements or change in working practices. To ensure patients have access to the people that they need to see, along with the fact that our practice nurses need to increase, what can we do to improve recruitment and retention of not just GPs, but of all staff? And start with Dr. Williams, if that's okay.
Thank you.
There's several things that I would suggest. Firstly, it needs to be a less pressured environment, and some of the digital changes that we've seen have been an attempt to make things less pressured. So the ability to put in electronic consultation requests, where somebody can go onto a web page and submit a message, often in a structured form, to the practice, helps reduce the number of people that are trying to make telephone calls first thing in the day. And so I'd say across the team, I think we need an environment where people have enough time to think, to work with colleagues, and to develop these new elements that we have. The new contract has helped broaden the skill mix that is there, ready and waiting in GP surgeries, in terms of bringing first contact physiotherapists in, I think has been an excellent move. Again, pharmacists add another dimension. And again, we see the skill mix really improve But as alluded to earlier, I don't think patients easily understand that every time that they call, and there's often a learning journey for some of the patients about what how services, you know, who's there within the practice and how's that's organised. I think in terms of how our practice teams are able to understand each other and how they're able to describe what they do has been limited to some extent. I think that we don't do as well as we can in terms of putting out information on the internet, and again in rapidly changing times. Across COVID, we've seen a lot of changes to how practices are able to communicate out to their population. And I absolutely take what's been said earlier that digital tools are not for everyone, that some people absolutely have to use the phone. They can't, they don't have the appropriate technology, or they don't have skills or desire to use some of these things. Again, we need to keep the phone lines open. So we need to look at evidence at what some of these things that we're doing and understand, are they helping? And when we've got a system of multiple moving parts, trying to get that data, trying to interpret that is difficult. A lot of the research that we have round about how these changes have been received comes through telephone interviews of people who have used services or who are part of providing these services. So absolutely, we need more data to understand what we're doing. We need to understand where the pressure points are, and we need to make sure there is appropriate resource to support those areas that are under pressure.
I don't know if anyone else wants to come in. I should have mentioned at the outset that if you know, our questioners direct it to one person, it doesn't exclude everyone else. Please use the chat box on the platform to put an arrow in the chat box, and I'll come to you. Can I add something else into the mix on top of the line of questioning that Sandesh has put? In terms of, there is wide national messaging on what the GP contract is, and some of the stuff that Wendy's mentioned about, you know, the qualifications and the expertise that the various different health professionals have. But there's also that layer of the local information going out about how a practice works and who's in the practice and what they can do, and, you know, and also that front end system of a surgery as well. You heard earlier our three panellists all mentioned that perhaps that front-end system often can be add to frustration for people, particularly in terms of like putting a queue, or I've had, in my area, I've had systems from some surgeries where after a certain period of time, the line goes dead, you know, that kind of thing. Can I throw that into the mix about how you're maybe seeing how locally things can be done better in terms of proactively speaking to patients or changing those front-end systems, and what capacity there is there to sort of like alleviate any of that frustration and improve knowledge? I can maybe be, Wendy was nodding away when I was speaking there, so I'm going to, yeah, you won't be doing that again, Wendy. I'll come to you first, and then I'll maybe go to Dr. Yadav.
So, yes, I think that there has to obviously to be more communication, more. You said that there was a kind of national drive about what each particular profession did. I don't think that was articulated very well for the GPN. Definitely not. And kind of going back to what they were saying at the earlier meeting, one of the things that they had for the practice nurse or the GPN was about injections and dressings, etc., which for us as a group, we felt that was a very outdated description of a general practice nurse. In terms of getting the knowledge out to the public nationally, I think there has to be more information locally. The thing is that patients aren't attending the GP practices because obviously of the pandemic, we've had to change our way of working. Prior to that, when patients were seeing the doctor or the practice nurse or the physio or the pharmacist. Perhaps there was lots of information within the GP practices, but, you know, in the screens, etc. And that was a really good way to capture people. And we've lost that now because we're, you know, but patients aren't getting into the surgery the way that they used to. We can't just drop in, or most practices, you're not able to drop in now. And that's fair enough, but we have lost that that way of getting knowledge through. And then, you know, if it wasn't me that was there, perhaps somebody else was, and that can get pass that message, get passed through. So we definitely have to look at more local ways, and we've lost a lot of the kind of local things, the like local newspapers. People aren't reading them, etc. So it's how trying to think about how best we can get that knowledge out, because not everybody uses Instagram, not everybody uses Facebook, and whilst they are very, very good ways of getting information out, it's not for everybody. So more targeted local, whether that's, you know, through workplaces, schools, etc.
Thank you. And can I come to Dr. Yadav?
Thanks very much. I totally agree with what Wendy said there, you know, in terms of and what you suggested, the local information for more the front end, as you said, for people to be informed. But having said that, with the pandemic time, there has been, and, you know, with the contract changes, there's lots of changes have been done more kind of centrally with lots of practice changes. New services have been put in. So there has been, I think the biggest thing is kind of the two-way thing. So there is an importance about the local information given to the local population, which, because the things and services are slightly different in each practice, how they work and how the things are being met for the patient needs there. So there's certainly there's a lack of communication and how to give this information to public, firstly, a kind of broader view as to the new changes happening, you know, in terms of how the ANPs have started work as a clinician in primary care, which has been the kind of, they have been there in the role, but the role has been enhanced, and that's, these changes have taken place as kind of, they would have been kind of gradually been happening, but they are suddenly catalyzed by the COVID-19 pandemic. And the information to the public has not been that intense to start with. So there is still a kind of lack of intake from public in terms of the ANP appointment. Still patients prefer to like see GP, although there has been, I totally agree with Dr. Gulani there, that nurses do a brilliant job, and our ANPs, what they do and see patients is absolutely marvelous. It's a kind of first time approach when the patients see them. So there's initial hesitation. Once they see them, there's a kind of confidence builds up over time, and the service runs smoothly. So there's this lack of communication, which is, again, as I said, we want to kind of more national coverage in addition to the local coverage, which is important. And this adds up to the staff morale. And if, with this lack of staff morale, with a lot of negative media coverage, lack of resources, lack of staffing, it has got a knock-on effect on the staffing itself. You find it difficult to recruit other person in the same post because there are less people, but if the morale is less, then, you know, we get less and less staff. We've got, from the PCIP point of view, we've got services where we have got funding to get the physios. We're not getting it. We've got funding to get pharmacists. We're not getting them. So there's kind of a knock-on effect which goes on. So better funding, better working condition, more staff morale, as Chris previously talked about, improving IT services, would be a way as well. I think if we can make the IT more efficient and people to not to struggle with IT, but if IT is more, we've got different systems in primary care which don't talk to each other. So if we can make IT more efficient, it'll make the working life more better for people. For the staff, and in turn, it will have an impact on patients. The happier staff will have more happy, positive patient outcome.
Thank you. And Wendy Panton wanted to come back.
Thank you.
Sorry, I interrupted you. We crossed over there. That's an inevitable issue sometimes with doing these hybrid meetings. Wendy, you wanted to come back in on sustainability.
Yeah, just to pick up on sustainability and how obviously we have the crisis of GPs, but also a crisis of GPNs as well. We know that it's an ageing workforce, and how do we get young, fresh talent into general practice nursing? Because obviously, I think it is one of the best professions within primary care, and really passionate about getting new nurses into general practice nursing. So we're not exposed to general practice nursing during our nurse training. So it's definitely something that we have to look at to get university placements within general practices. But again, that's all dependent on our GP employers working with us to get GP to get student nurses and exposing them to that. Also, there's a very when a doctor becomes a GP, there is obviously a training programme for them within general practice nursing. There is a GPN course within NES does, which is excellent, but there is you're not guaranteed to get a place on that. So, but there's not that kind of structured education programme that we have, and there's lots and lots of people who do nurses that are doing master's level modules, etc., in long-term conditions, and not a way to kind of consolidate that into a recognised qualification. Also, there's variations between different practices on payment. So there's not the standard within the NHS, the agenda for change. So it's all dependent on the practice. So one person could be doing the exact same job in one GP practice and another person doing the same job, but completely different paying conditions. So there's not that uniformed paying condition terms for your employment, which puts a lot of people off because you're not employed by the NHS. You're employed by the GP. So you've not always got the same terms and conditions. Obviously, you can negotiate that with your employer, but not everybody feels confident in that, especially if you're quite early in your career. That's something that takes, you know, time to be able to build up those skills. So there's lots of different things that affect how nurses get into general practice. And staying, the attrition rate can be quite high as well, because perhaps they're not feeling that they've got that support because everybody is really, really busy. And we don't have that time that we had when I started in general practice. We had, it's not that we were always busy, but we seemed to have more time that we were able to get a wee bit more support, and that seems to have kind of tailed off a wee bit. So it's not as an attractive post now that it used to be, but obviously we have to make sure that we're getting the people, the nurses into general practice as well, and looking at what that new refreshed role is, because it is changing.
Thank you. That's really interesting, some of what you've just said there about training in particular. Can I come to my colleague Paul O'Kane for some questions?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. I think the theme that I'm looking to focus on is the kind of patient perspective, and I think a lot of that has been covered in the answers, which is most helpful. But perhaps if I can just kind of drill down a wee bit in terms of what patients have said in our response to our call to views. One of the things that they've highlighted is perhaps their negative perceptions of receptionist teams within GPs. And I think we could all probably relate some of that about people's attitude, if you like, towards those staff and seeing them very often as gatekeepers or negatively as barriers to seeing the GP, which I think is often, you know, wrong. But I suppose I'm just trying to get a sense of how do we better communicate perhaps the triage pathway that now exists for a lot of practices. I'm just thinking that are triage pathways clearer in emergency medicine perhaps than they are in general practice. So just keen to understand people's own experience of that, and indeed how we continue to communicate with patients.
Anyone you'd like to go to in particular? Or we go to Sorry, Dr. Maybe, Williams first?
Maybe Dr. Williams to yep. start, yeah, thanks. Amira.
Yes, so I think there's a particular dilemma around what are we doing to support our receptionists. In some places we're viewing them as, you know, care navigators that we, you know, that we are recognising that we have equipped them with knowledge of the healthcare system, about that we've tried to give them enough knowledge that they can help direct somebody who's describing a circumstance or a certain set of symptoms to a place where they can get seen very quickly. And so we're trying to have them do a role where they can find the places of the system that have capacity. And as highlighted earlier, that won't always match expectations of patients who are, or the patient's relatives who are calling in, and especially if there's a degree of urgency to the call, and as highlighted earlier, especially if there's if there's a long wait in them getting through to, you know, to speaking to a person. And that reflects a system that's running hot, where there is activity everywhere. And I'm going to suggest that one of the things that might not be immediately intuitive that we need to do is that we need to increase the number of training activities that are there as a team. So as GPs, as receptionists, as practice nurses, as pharmacists, as first contact physios, and the wider team beyond that. To be able to do that properly, we need to close our doors to everything but emergencies. And we talk, so that doesn't need to happen often, but it needs to happen multiple times a year. So what we might describe as protected learning time, or PLT, and that's been something that has been very difficult for us to secure. We know that in the past, there have been arrangements which have allowed NHS 24 to cover some of the phone lines, you know, in an afternoon, for example, where we wouldn't be expecting as many people as many of our patient population to phone in with an urgent query that needs to be dealt with the same day. But it's only if we're able to close our doors, to stop, to pause, to take a breath, to share our experiences of how these different parts of the system are working, that we'll be able to allow our receptionists to be able to speak to patients and their relatives in the way that sort of is maximally efficient in picking up on on their concerns, to making sure that they're that they're able to give an appropriate place to go and options where possible. So my plea would really be around sort of this development of the team, especially given the new territory that we are into.
Thank you. Thanks. Paul, do you want to come back in?
Yeah, no, thanks for that answer. I think that was helpful. And you kind of mentioned bits of how do we create space, I suppose, for training, and maybe by diverting people via other kind of pathways in terms of NHS 24, maybe having a bit of a support role. Keen to just understand maybe the panel's experience of things like NHS 24. Obviously, people would be, you know, kind of directed there maybe more in terms of an alternative to presenting at A&E, but I think what we've seen over the last few while is frustration, I think, with some of the accessibility of that. You know, 240,000 calls unanswered in a 2-month period. People, I think the convener mentioned frustration with if it rings out of the GP surgery as well. So I think just to get a sense of, do we feel that our kind of alternative systems in terms of phone advice are up to par in terms of being able to actually support people?
Thank you. I'll maybe no one's particularly put anything in the chat box they want to come in on that, Paul. But if you want to, please raise your hand and I'll bring you in. Maybe if we hear from Dr. Yadav. Unmute your microphone. Thank you.
Thanks very much for this. So I actually totally agree with the points which have been made before. I would probably emphasise the receptionists are, if you think about patient journey in the National Health Services, this is their first point of contact for them to howsoever, whether it's an acute emergency condition or a chronic condition, that's where, you know, as the first impression is the best impression, as we say. So the reception is a very, very important part of our general practice. So I totally agree that we need kind of more training and funding in terms of staff. So even in kind of, you know, when we need kind of, we have been getting signposting training, for example, recently, but we need kind of more time dedicated for the, so they can do that. NHS 24 has been brilliant. We have had few sessions in the past. We used to get NHS 24 cover for them, but this has gradually been withdrawn, and we are finding as a practice quite difficult to get these training sessions for the practice, even for GPs, because of lack of NHS 24 cover for these training sessions. And overall, I've as a personal in practice have noticed NHS 24, the what they have been doing in terms of patient consultation has been brilliant. Their work has been tremendous. The amount of work and the patient expectation has been dealt very good. During the normal working day, NHS 24, if there is any emergency which has to be dealt by general practice, they will duly direct it to GP practices for it to be managed further on. And patients do generally usually will contact GP unless it's an emergency, and they will contact NHS 24. But they are I have got all praises for NHS 24, the way they work, and the management of patients have been great. But I'll probably want some more input in terms of NHS 24 cover for training, staff training, especially reception training, more capacity, and more communication to the patient. Just for example, when the latest changes in the vaccine transformation project was made, we had umpteen number of calls suddenly from patients requesting for vaccination appointments, but probably they have not seen that the new number is now for them to call a different place for these vaccination appointments rather than GP surgery as a point of contact. So just the information going out to patient would actually help general practice, even receptions to manage. And maybe even before coming here, I had a discussion with our reception staff as well. And all the overwhelming comment they said to me was they would probably want to raise something about communication to patients and how things are communicated. And end of the day, it will help their work life to get more better with less demands and top phone ringing all the time. So just a little point from them, which I would like to emphasise as well. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I come to Wendy Panton?
Dr. Yadav is really, I've just got to echo everything that he said. I was just thinking there, I wonder if there was any kind of thought given about receptionists, about a training package for them, almost like, you know, like these kind of certain, like, for want of a better word, like modules that they have to do, like courses that they have to do, and forgive me if it is already there. So not just about signposting, about consultation skills, communication skills, etc., just and de-escalation of things as well as part of their kind of induction programme, you know, having that kind of protected time as well, or is it something that they do even before they start their post, before they actually go into the kind of front line, so to speak, of kind of reception. I think we're all in agreement that perhaps receptionist isn't the best term, so whatever term we're using, care navigator, that they've got that training in place, communication, de-escalation, signposting, everything that encompasses what that their role is going to be. So that was just something that I was kind of mindful of.
Thank you very much, Wendy. Evelyn Tweed has a follow-up question to Paul's line of questioning.
Thanks, convener. Yeah, it was just to follow up with Dr. Williams on the point he made about training. And he said it was quite difficult to sort of set aside days to close practices for training, etc. Dr. Williams, is this a sort of general thing about training, planning, you know, having that time to sort of look to the future? And do you think that if we do get the communication right on alternative pathways, that GPs will actually have that time?
So I'd probably just try and describe some elements of the training for a bit of clarity. So firstly, there's training going on all the time in some practices, in that we have foundation year doctors, we have GP specialist trainees, we have medical students, we have a whole wide range of professions who are there to learn, to work, but also to learn. There are, I suppose, the events I'm talking about is the scheduled closure of non-emergency services for a period of a few hours, typically in the midweek, when we expect there to be a lower number of emergencies come through. And the sort of activities that we are then able to do is to be able to hear presentations about cases that have gone, that haven't gone well or that have gone well, to hear about upcoming changes to services. And I suppose, especially when to pick up on the comments that we've had already about whether a GP knows about a type of non-medical intervention that is running, that a patient is aware of and wonders why a GP might not know about a green initiative or other, and often that's the information that is coming through, that we're subjected to, that there are large volumes of information. So how do we understand which services are currently up and running in the area, or which are coming to a close? Well, you need team events to be able to cover the breadth of this, and for all the members of the team to be up to speed with, this rapidly evolving and changing landscape. There's sometimes, I think, a perception that, why didn't somebody know about one part of the system? Well, it's because there is so much change and continual change. And unless we can be able to sense check amongst clinical teams and the wider administrative teams played into that, then we face difficulty in providing consistent experiences for our patients.
Thank you. And Dr. Yadav wants to come back in.
Thanks very much. I just wanted to, on the same point which I said previously about communication, there's a very common theme which I've come across in primary care, is about how patients feel. It's a general perception of patients about confidentiality with the reception staff, that they generally are not confident and share the confidential information. Although we try to put into notice boards and try to give information to patients that they're bound by same confidentiality agreement, which everybody is bound in the practice. They are part of confidential team, but probably that doesn't fill up patients with confidence. Generally, they will see the majority of the professional staff are bound by professional regulations, like whether it's a general medical council regulation or nursing council regulation, whereas for the reception staff, there is probably from patient perspective, there's nothing to regulate. A kind of confidentiality statement, but it is something which I would probably want more communication, maybe in a broader sense from government for everybody to know that this is a confidentiality issue. And you can discuss your confidential information with reception staff. And second thing, I wanted to share a kind of frustration which reception staff very commonly have is, which is a kind of knock-on effect from lack of appointments, lack of support structure, where do you give appointment to patient, lack of places where they can signpost patients to. So this leads to more frustration, and that is probably experienced by reception staff much more than any other staff. Thank you.
Thank you. They're all excellent points. I'm going to move on to talking about social prescribing. Questions from Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. What does the panel see as the main barriers to GPs engaging with social prescribing? And could I go to Dr. Williams first, please?
So I would probably cite time and an available capacity as high up there. The other thing I would highlight is the knowledge of what services are available. And as highlighted in the earlier session this morning, there are many sources of support and schemes that are present as in a pilot phase or have some funding, but who don't continue over time. To be able to keep track of these individual schemes and who's administrating, who's running, what the contact details are, that is difficult. And I would highlight that, so Alice was mentioned earlier on in terms of a local information system for Scotland as being the something that is capable of tracking some of these different schemes and making it available to everyone, everyone who lives in Scotland and beyond, because it's there. It is got a very useful interface. It is searchable. So if information is updated, then people can understand what's out there. I think there's very much an argument for other professionals to be able to help patients navigate some of these structures. So link workers, I think they are, potentially better able to keep up to date with and keep in touch with multiple other organisations that provide different specialist type of support, and be able to make sure that that's available to the sort of patients that might not realise that it's there. So if you like to match people up to what's available, to things that might be useful and of interest. And I would pick up in terms of some of the survey responses that there is a range of reactions to a GP suggesting things that aren't that aren't a conventional medicine or that aren't what a patient had gone into a consultation thinking was available or thinking what might benefit them. And I would, I guess, highlight in terms of how we work, we will often go through a whole range of different things and suggest them to a patient, to their to the people that are with them, and say they might, certain of those options might stick in their memory as either sort of highly suitable or highly unsuitable. So it's how we navigate that information landscape. And my thoughts are Alice is a superb resource. It is underused. And I think, if there was an injection of resource into Alice an ability to make more people aware of that it exists and what it can be used for, my thoughts that would be a very helpful step.
Thank you. Gillian.
Picking up on Dr. Williams' comments about link workers, I've heard concerns raised that due to limited capacity amongst link workers and the financial strain people are facing due to cost of living, much of link workers' time is actually being taken up helping people to apply for benefits, and that they don't have as much time to engage with social prescribing. What are the panel's thoughts on this, and do we simply need more link workers? Or should that part of the role be separated out and allocated to welfare rights advisors in GPs' practices, for example? And could I come to Wendy first on this, please?
Wendy.
Okay, so yeah, I think you've raised a good point. A financial advisor could perhaps be a better option. The only thing that I would say for that then is it's another person that the patient's seeing. That's the only thing. So perhaps the patient or service user feels they're getting passed from pillar to post. So, but what is their priority? So it's finding out what matters to the patient. Okay, so that is certainly a good step, a good idea. Alice, as Dr. Williamson said, is very much underutilised, so that's definitely getting that up and running and making people, staff aware, competing priorities for GPs and GPNs, etc. When a patient comes in expecting perhaps a prescription for something, and then we're telling them that, well, actually, your diabetes will get better if, you know, if you do X, Y, Z, and it's patients are quite resistant to that. Or not all patients, that's not true. Some patients can be quite resistant to that. And for us to prescribe them such a, you know, a thing is, it can be quite challenging. So thank you.
Thank you. And Dr. Williams wants to come back in.
It was just to mention, in terms of the welfare rights assistance, in terms of the support that people need to be able to, you know, manage their lives and their health, and to stop financial problems from becoming health problems. Absolutely, we are supportive of putting that resource in settings where people can reach that, and that absolutely that includes the general practice settings. There is a slight difficulty about how many people we can get into any one building in any one day. Much of the general practice estate is already fully utilised in terms of the physical space, and some of the initiatives that we've seen round about other digital ways of doing things is also because we're out of physical space. So that, again, coming back to points made this morning, if patients have to travel a large distance to services, will services be underused? And we would absolutely want to see general practice in the heart of communities, and that includes innovations round about welfare advice.
Thank you, Gillian.
Thanks, Camille.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to questions from Emma Harper around signposting, picking up on some of the things that have already been mentioned. Emma.
Yep, thanks, convener. Yep. Good morning to panel number two. Some of the information has been covered already by Dr. Chris Williams. You spoke about the benefits of ALICE, which is a local information service for Scotland. And in our briefing papers, the Health Improvement Scotland website has a 10-step guide to care navigation and general practice, and it recommends that individual practices collate and maintain their own list of local service providers. And I know that GPs will know their own locations, but is it realistic to expect that GPs would collate and maintain their own databases when there are programmes such as ALICE out there, and also there's one regionally, like Dumfries and Galloway, DG Locator has one which is really accessible with an app. So how do you feel about the Health Improvement Scotland recommending that GPs keep their own database of social prescribing places?
Dr. Williams.
I'm generally very fond of Health Care Improvement Scotland's sort of contributions around about quality improvement and about how we make changes to our systems and then evaluate how those changes are working to see whether what we're doing to see whether that's helping things. So there are examples. I had an email in this morning about a green scheme that is launching in our area, and I couldn't find it on ALICE when I jumped on there. So I think there are examples where the different systems aren't up to date or aren't synchronised. I would certainly see ALICE as being a resource that can help practices to keep track of some of these changes to the multiple different organisations that do multiple different things. So I'm happy with their recommendation.
Thank you.
Emma?
Yep, just again, so kind of going back to looking at that, I've had a look on Alice myself. I can't find any men's sheds in Dumfries and Galloway, and I know we've got them from Stranraer to Lockerbie. So there is an issue about it being most up-to-date and accurate. And I'm just also wondering about, like, what steps can be taken to help support GP practices to enable effective signposting, so using your care navigators or other methods. What's the best way to communicate what's out there for people?
I'll go back to Dr. Williams first, but just a reminder to others, if you want to contribute, just use the chat box. Dr. Williams.
So in so many ways, general practice does things according to the local connections in terms of, we heard earlier about how some patients get their information from the walls of waiting rooms rather than over websites. And so the practice teams tend to know what ways of getting a message out it will be the most useful or will get the message to the people that we're trying to reach. There's so much information out there that is coming from different directions. We get constant stories in the media about some types of treatment that are new or groups that recognise gaps in healthcare systems for groups of patients. We'll sometimes then have a range of inquiries on one sort of topic based on a story that's been in through the press, and our communication systems need to be very, very dynamic. How we keep track of this information, again, we need to make the best use of technology, and I say that the ALICE system is available to cover the wider organisations, including third sector organisations, but there's also a job just to keep track of the systems that the hospital systems that we are referring into, about trying to understand how those systems are functioning this week compared to a year ago. Which waiting lists are potentially causing our patients discomfort and difficulty. So that there's, the range of inquiries that we field on a daily basis about, say, the hospital treatment side of things is massive. And that's before, say, we get to some of these other, these other organisations that in some way are less well connected to general practice, or that are less visible to general practice. But ideally, we'd like to keep track of all these things, but it's tricky.
And can I come to Dr. Yadav?
Thanks very much. I just want to emphasise some of the points which have already been said. Social prescribing is very important, especially when it comes to tackling loneliness. But there are practical issues. I totally agree with the Health Improvement Scotland that GP should maintain a list. But it's quite difficult, as Dr. Williams said, is for us to maintain the list, because many of these services are not under, formed by GP. They are kind of third party or voluntary organisation which have got these services. So the onus is for them to inform GPs as to what services are there. And then we can certainly direct the patient to these relevant services once we get the information. There's a practical point about the trust in some of the services in terms of how efficient they are, what is the capacity of these services. Many times we end up signposting patients to these services only to find that they have now stopped working. Unless we have a kind of more proper communication about the availability of these services and a kind of more unified way, I think it'll be difficult and challenging task for practices to keep on chopping and changing these things, and for directing the patients to these services where even the GPs are not very well informed about how efficient they are, what how their working capacity is. To I would appreciate some kind of central database of these things where things could be accessed by GP services directly, and a kind of more active database if could be maintained, and GPs can tap into it, like there's talk about Alice today. So, yeah, so that would be my point on it. Thank you.
Thank you. And Wendy Panton.
I think maintaining a database for a GP practice would be a very arduous and difficult task for them to keep it up to date. And I think it's another thing that we're asking GP practices to do when we're already at stretching point. I don't think that GPs, nurses, physios, etc. can be expected to know absolutely everything that's out there, as much as we would like to be able to maintain all that information. I think that's really difficult. Therefore, I think access for practices to clinical link workers, equitable throughout Scotland. The patient doesn't have to physically see that clinical link worker, but having access to them, whether that's through via telephone or whether it's through Attend Anywhere, etc., who that's their role, that's their job to know those things, and they've got access to that, so that the patient's not missing out on what's out there, because there is so much out there that is excellent services, but for the practice staff to be able to have that knowledge on their own, I think that's quite a difficult task to be asked.
Okay, thank you. And one final question,
yep,
then.
Yep, just a quick. According to the Support in Mind report that's in front of me, it says that 25 to 50% of GP appointments focus on non-medical issues such as social isolation, financial struggles and bereavement. And I'm aware that there's an RCGP training for signposting. Does the RCGP training cover signposting for likes of social isolation and financial issues as well? That would be a question for Dr. Yadav or Dr. Williams.
OK, I'll bring in Dr. Yadav.
Thank you. Signposting, as you said, Convener, is a very important part, and RCGP has been doing work on it, and we've had the signposting training for the staff. But when it comes to the local things available, and what is available locally would be a challenge in terms of GPs to keep a tab on what is happening locally. And as I previously said, in terms of the services, sometimes keeps on changing. Many of these services have we don't have any say on their working pattern, as sometimes there's an issue about funding for them. So some of these services, like I have had patients whom I've referred to services which were working, only to come to know once I asked patients to be referred to there as a self-referral, I realized that the services are stopped now in the area. So things fall back onto GP as to manage them back again, which could have been dealt more efficiently if the services have been running, or if we had known about the services. So yes, it's good to have the services, but we would like some kind of information from other parties who have established these services to be proactively informing GP about it, so that we can keep a note of it, and if the services are being stopped, then if we get information about it as well.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Sue.
Thanks, Convener, and thank you. We've had quite a lot of information today. I suppose I'm just thinking within... bearing in mind what we've heard about the challenges with signposting and the pressures that we're facing right now in terms of the immediate pressures and the medium-term pressures as we come out of the pandemic, what sort of things do you suggest that we'd look to try and do as solutions to tackle those issues with signposting, with the services changing, the issues with funding, and what could be some short-term solutions for us to implement quickly to alleviate the immediate pressures of coming out of the pandemic? Dr. Williams, perhaps, maybe initially, if that's okay.
Yeah, I'll just pick up on the previous question, because it was about an RCGP resource, and I'm quite happy to look into what is covered, and whether, and especially if there are any areas where the committee thinks it could be strengthened, I'm very happy to go back and see what updating we can do and what rewriting to make sure that it is as contemporaneous as it needs to be. In terms of solutions, I would give one clear solution, and that's the public messaging side of things. It is very difficult for individual patients to understand the whole of what has changed over the last few years. There have been lots of messages going out in terms of the COVID changes, but in the background we've had an agenda of primary care reform that we have been trying in terms of the composition of the team in general practice surgeries to change the skill mix that is there. I think getting that message out, very much we need to counter the narrative about people being fobbed off when the efforts are genuinely to get them to someone who can help them or that can start their journey of assistance and in a timely way. I think what we need to be clear that we are trying to avoid harm through people waiting to get a service that might have difficulties with availability or might be able to see a certain person or a certain role, but it might be quite a wait to get there. I think there are misunderstandings about what referrals are. For example, that for some of our first contact physio therapists, their role it's not so much referral, but an appointment system to try and get again somebody seen within a short space of time, so that their health condition can be assessed. So that's different from the historical physiotherapist role, where people associate physiotherapy with getting rehabilitation instructions, with being given exercises to do. And the first contact physio model is different. An interesting aspect of that is that when you look at these schemes, it isn't freeing up general practitioner time in the way it was envisaged, but it is providing a very quality service to our patients. It is bringing skills into the practice that other members of the team can also benefit from. So there are elements of this, strategic elements of this, that we need to communicate out to the population we serve, our patients, their relatives.
Thank you. Dr. Yadav.
Thanks very much. I was essentially going to speak on the same things which Dr. Williams has already touched upon. Firstly, I would like to say that we need more information to GP practice regarding the resources available. Secondly, more training to the staff in terms of signposting, maybe more funding available for that, more time, dedicated time if it could be given. With, like we said, about the NHS24 cover for the during the time of the training. The third thing I would emphasize is increased communication to public, so they have got more confidence in uptake of these services. And if these services have got an easy way of access for patient to even self-refer, so if the information is out there and patient are able to self-refer, that will be a further step ahead. In terms of signposting. Thank you.
Sue, do you have a follow-up question?
I'm fine, thanks, convener.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to questions from Evelyn Tweed. Evelyn.
Thanks, convener, and good morning to panel two. My questions are around service design, and we often hear from the public that they haven't really been involved in the changes to GP services. To what extent has the public been involved in the co-design of primary care services, and in what way? And how has the general practice workforce been involved also? And possibly to Wendy, and if anyone else wants to come in.
Sure, I'll go to Wendy Panton.
Okay, so I think we heard clearly from
the service users this morning that they didn't feel that they had been involved very, very much, and I would echo those sentiments. I would also say, from the GPN perspective, that in terms of services that have been transferred from general practice to health and social care partnerships, that perhaps there's not been as much of an involvement of GPNs and other practice staff within that, that they could be using their kind of expert knowledge to help design services. So there's a lot of things that perhaps communication would help with, and that can certainly be progressed further in the future as things move on, and involving both service users and other members of staff as well. Thank you.
Thank you. And we'll go for a GP perspective on this. We'll go to Dr. Yada first, and then to Dr. Williams.
Thank you very much. I totally agree with what Wendy said, that there has been public involvement to some extent, but we definitely would like more public involvement in terms of the changes which have been happening. There have been lots of changes from, when we talk about 2018 GP contract, there have been lots of changes for GPs and lots of ways of new ways of working, which are, I suppose, because there has been lots of changes, and there have been some patient involvement, but not to that extent. The information to the public is not there, and these services are not very patients are not very much informed about them. So there is information coming gradually, but the speed of information coming to public is at a lower pace than what is actually happening on the ground. We'll definitely say that we need more public involvement and patient involvement in further decision making or changes in primary care.
Thank you. And Dr. Williams.
So I would probably identify that there is lots of feedback that practices get from their patient population. I don't think so in terms of how consultations might formally occur when there's major service change. I don't think there has been the sort of consultation in the way that would occur if a large hospital was being built, for example, sort of multi-million pound endeavour. And I'd come back to what I said earlier on, that general practice is almost in a constant state of change. There's a sort of continual flux of how we do things, how we schedule our appointments, what technologies we're using, what people are part of the team. The 2018 contractual changes, yes, absolutely, sort of changed some of that. And again, I think that it would be interesting for health boards and for health and social care partnerships to get feedback around about how that is working, because there's certainly change that's still to come. You know, while we're sort of waiting for this contract to fully bed in, there's still, I think, further steps to be taken beyond that. I guess I might make reference. There was a reference earlier on to the primary care improvement plans that are submitted to try and sort of track where we are in that implementation of that contract, how many different people are employed in terms of physiotherapists, pharmacists, other types of worker. And again, these things give us some sense of where things are at, but there's been a different pace of change in different board areas, in different health and social care partnerships. There's probably, it's a difficult task in bringing together feedback round about that. And I recognise the importance of service design in seeking the views of users.
Thank you. Evelyn, do you want to come back in with any supplementary questions?
Thanks, Convener. My second question has been covered off by answers already.
Thank you very much. It's Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you very much, Convener. Certainly, one of the things that has come up is the fact that service design should be informed by evidence. And my first question is, how can we build a more effective evidence base for improving service design? And also, what lessons do we need to learn to improve the future design of alternative pathways? And if I could ask that to Dr. Williams first, please. Thanks.
Thank you.
So we, in terms of evidence, one of the big changes that we are going to be seeing over coming months is being able to understand the system activity in hours in general practice. So we've always had data at an individual practice level about how many people are being seen and how appointments are being used. But it's been difficult to get a greater oversight of this. And what we don't want to do is extrapolate in ways that that don't pick up on what's actually happening. And I guess particularly in terms of where there is activity that's displaced, or if we are making changes to one part of the service, what impact do we see that on other parts of the service? So we now have a technical means in general practice to be able to extract that information from GP clinical systems, and to be able to, I suppose, for the first time in Scotland, get a sort of a much higher level, so at a cluster level or at a board level, around about what sort of activity is occurring, and what individual on a role specific level as well, you know, what the sort of things that are happening, you know, and comparing them across different points of time.
Will I bring in, is there anyone else wants to come in that, or I'll come back to you, Stephanie, for a follow-up question? Yep. I'm not seeing any of our other panellists wanting to come in, so I'll just, if you do, nope. Please let us know in the chat box. Otherwise, Stephanie, on you go.
That's fine. Yep. If I could just pick up my second question with Wendy. I'm wondering what specific actions should be prioritised to improve service delivery, and also should scaling things up be a priority? Scaling up successful things to national level. And I'm thinking of, for example, there's the case study from Audit Scotland that's in the papers this week, where you've got Highland Council introducing primary mental health care workers, and the evaluation and outcomes from that showing that 78% of young people and 95% of parents felt that the support had mostly or completely helped their situation. Thanks.
Wendy.
Yeah, definitely. I think that is something that we absolutely have to do, is evidence and showcase what is happening within primary care, within general practice. So looking at working and involving primary care improvement teams with the PDSA, test of change, etc. So that would be definitely something that I would be very keen to see to be done, because we want to focus on what's the things that are the good things that are happening within general practice, within primary care. So definitely. Can you repeat your question again? Sorry, what was the first part of the question?
The first part was, Julie, what specific actions should be prioritised to improve service delivery? And then that second part was, should that be one of those priorities? So the other things.
Definitely. Absolutely, definitely. Mental health would definitely be a priority, and it's really, you know, it's all down to individual practices and what their priorities. Every practice is going to have different priorities and different needs for their patients. So I think that bringing that kind of local perspective into it, with that quality improvement and working quality improvement teams working with general practice, because we know that in general practice there is lots of really good improvement work done. But perhaps not evidenced and showcased the way that it could be and should be done. So, you know, individual things for individual practices. Thank you.
And can I just pick up on that wee bit there as well?
Yeah.
See, is there a conflict then as well between the kind of evidence-based approach and also the idea of patient participation in co-production? Is there a problem with them pushing up against each other at times, or how do we get them to integrate and work effectively together?
I don't think I can really fully answer that question for you, but my initial thoughts would be no, that there shouldn't be, and you know, for any kind of quality improvement, we want to involve service users to meet. How can we evaluate it without having their input and their thoughts into it? My initial reaction would be no, but I would be keen to hear from other people as well to hear what their thoughts are. Thank you.
Want to particularly come in on mental health support workers, Dr. Williams.
Yes, thank you for raising this again, because I don't think that our answers have fully covered the mental health aspects that are out there, and as highlighted, the desire for easy, straightforward access from a primary care setting. And there is we mentioned earlier about how patients and their families might not understand fully how services are organised, but there is a key advantage for me in understanding this primary care mental health worker. So the individuals working in this service being attached to and deployed through primary care, not being part of a secondary care organisation. So in terms of the priorities and the ability to focus on delivering these services in community settings, but on behalf of a community service, and again with the emphasis being on the primary care, because say often our community mental health teams are attached to secondary care. I wanted also just to mention on the evidence base and is there a conflict between people's experience and the evidence that we're building, and I would again point out the qualitative research side of things, that at the moment without clear data on sort of numbers of people going through the system at different points in time and outcomes, that the interviews that our researchers do in many different settings, and that's in terms of exercise referral schemes, as well as link workers, as well as first contact physios, you know, all these different parts of the system are being assessed by different groups, in across different parts of the country, and I do think that these interviews will pick up on sentiment expressed by people who've used the service, as well as the sort of thoughts of people who are developing and delivering the service.
Thank you. We're going to move on to a final area of questioning around inequalities from Sue Webber. Sue.
Thanks, Convener. With the panel this morning, some of the patient representatives were talking about the health literacy issue and the fact that there might be those, what I'm trying to find the word, the savvy patients that will be able to direct themselves to the alternative pathways and are more aware of their condition. But so, and there was also those that weren't in that position that still ultimately need to see the GP to get that primary diagnosis, I suppose. So in the process of promoting the more effective use of our alternative pathways, how can everyone's route into primary healthcare be protected and that we don't discriminate against that group that really needs to see the GP initially to try and understand what's actually going on? I'm sure you'll all want to respond to that one, so I'm not sure who
wants to
go first.
We'll go to Dr. Yada first of all.
Thanks very much for this. It's a very, very important area in terms of where lots of work needs to be done. This is one particular area which has been highlighted since the COVID-19 pandemic in terms of inequalities in healthcare, inequalities in attainment of good health, inequalities in access to healthcare, and that's very different in different subgroups. So, different people with chronic illnesses, people with disability, people who have got learning difficulties, how they access healthcare is quite different. People who are of different languages and mm-hmm. cultural background. This has all been highlighted. Just to give you crude data, the number of patients who died of COVID-19, unfortunately, and the people who are dying from other conditions is quite high. And if you think the inequalities and the problems because of inequalities is actually more than four times the mortality you see in pandemic in like say 10 years time. So this is, has been accrued data extrapolated from our local health board when we had the meeting on inequalities. So this is a very, very important area, and how to manage this, how to get on top of it is, it was a big challenge. So firstly, there is very important part of it is the communication. Communication to the patient to inform them how they can access in terms of language barriers to get more interpreter service used, for in terms of different cultural background to have more cultural awareness to the staff and the public. In terms of how people are able to access, in terms of how, you know, with the COVID pandemic, we have changed the way we have been working. There used to be more than 90% face-to-face consultations before. Now, we are post-pandemic, still not fully post-pandemic. We are only up to 50% face-to-face consultation. There's still a lot of telephone consultation goes on. There's a video consultation goes on for the right reason. Some patients do want it. But again, some people who are who have got language barriers, it's difficult for them to do telephone consultation. It's difficult for them to do video consultation, especially if they're not IT literate, especially the elderly people. So how to make the service accessible to all to reduce the strain on the service, to make it more equitable, it would be a big challenge. And I think that will be the main thing which I would want to move forward in terms of more access to the service to all and more data to be provided in terms of where the deficiencies are and so we can improve on it. Thank you.
Thank you. We've also, when we talk about the inequality, we've got the patient awareness, I suppose, but then there's also the geographical variation in service that we have. So in terms of what extent can equality in the availability of an access to the alternative pathways be ensured? And I'm thinking more in particular with perhaps some of the rural challenges that we face and the lack of consistency. So I was looking at Dr. Williams, who's up in Granton, and Wendy may be able to help as well. So, thanks.
Dr. Williams.
Yeah, so there are some services where you need a physical person in an actual location. We've learnt quite a lot about other services, about services that we can provide remotely. And I would also hammer home that some of these learning points were services that we didn't think could be delivered remotely. And again, I'll come back to physiotherapy as a service that we think of as being very hands-on, very people in the same room. But we know that through the pandemic, that there were some elements of that service that could still be delivered without being in the same physical space, that there's a lot that could be done by, but not everything, but there was a lot that could be done by telephone. So I absolutely take on board that, especially in sparsely populated rural areas, that there are difficulties around about scale, about how many sort of physical locations that one person would be able to cover when distributed across a sparse population. And I might come back to the digital disparity and inclusion issues. That if our starting point is we accept that some people cannot use certain digital services and that some people cannot travel, then we should be trying to create capacity around about these individuals and these communities so that we one of the difficulties we currently have is how we identify people who have told us that they don't have a smartphone, they're never going to have a smartphone, that they're, you know, that they can't use these things. And there's a section of our patients who could use some of these things, but so where upskilling would be possible, where it would, and again, where doing this would create capacity for the people who can't travel, who can't use devices, you know, who are unable. So in terms of how we shift around that capacity, in terms of how we make it more likely that people will have locations that they where there is a healthcare professional that they of the type that they need to see. So part of that is shifting the part of the population that we can upskill, and there's a difficulty in clarity in terms of whose responsibility it is to upskill patients and family where that is possible, where it's within touching distance, and also, I say, particularly how we record our systems weren't designed around you know, we're able to collect phone numbers or you know, mobile numbers, home numbers. It's difficult to collect information about whether somebody has broadband or whether they've used Zoom before, let alone whether they've tried to do a video consultation with a medical professional. A lot of people are surprised at what they can do when they're given a little bit of support to do that. That doesn't fully cover the rural difficulties that you describe, but my thoughts are there are digital ways that we can use digital working to try and make sure that there are people who, when they need to be in available for a rural area, that they can be.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. And I guess one of the things, picking up on what Dr. Williams says, giving people the confidence that they're not getting a lesser service, is something that's come through this morning as well. I don't know if you have any reflections on that.
So there are a lot of people out there who have got visions of general practice that are outdated in terms of what they might expect to be able to access, or who might give them the help or their assistance. And again, coming back to this idea that there are lots of very positive messages about what we can do for people in this very busy age in which we live. And there are ways that people can, you know, access services without having to leave their work for half a day, or, you know, that there are all sorts of changes that aren't just you know, aren't just around trying to shore things up. There's lots of advances that we're making in and amongst things, but getting that message out as picked up this in the morning session, that message needs to go out in through multiple different channels, through multiple means, and it might not be the most exciting news story for people to run. So there may well be, I say, other public campaigns that need to be funded to tell people about the services that are there for them here and now, not how they might have accessed services in the past. But I'd say that the change has been so rapid, but I think we are at a stage where we can describe the sort of consistent experience that we would hope people can receive.
You make a very good point about media coverage and news stories. Can I come finally to Wendy Panton?
Yeah, I was just wanting to pick up a wee bit about the health inequalities. I can't speak from a rural perspective, but just really to kind of reiterate the fact that, you know, I feel that patients have to get the right to choose the way that they want to access the service, and that the service should wrap around the patient or the service user, not the other way around. And absolutely everybody should have access to a fair and equitable service. Now, that doesn't necessarily, and thinking about terms of health literacy, etc., or signposting, that doesn't necessarily have to be the GP practice. Is there something there that a patient has got some sort of ability to access another human being, whether that's, you know, by telephone, and not just the patient, their carers, family, etc. So by giving a kind of not a named person, but a service that they can kind of link into if they've got any kind of questions, etc., but signposting, just to make sure that you are to try to make sure that people are getting that fair and equitable service that they deserve.
Thank you. Thank you. What a good point to end on. I want to thank all three of you for your time this morning and for everything that you've told us. Thank you again, both excellent panels and a lot for us to chew over. Our next meeting on the 15th of March, the committee will continue taking evidence of part of our inquiry into alternative pathways, or as we maybe should start calling them, pathways. I'm looking at Wendy because she made a very good point at the start of this session, to primary care. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you.